The Mabinogion. Translated from the Red Book of Hergest by a Lady Charlotte Guest, Volume 3. London T. Fisher Unwin, 11 Paternoster Buildings, MXCII. The Finding of Taliesin. P0.jpg. Introduction. Picture. P11.jpg. This third volume completes the series of Mabinogion and Tales translated by Lady Charlotte Guest. As in the two preceding volumes, I have compared Lady Guest's transcript with the original text in the Red Book of Hergest, and with Dr. Gwenogvryn Evans' scrupulously accurate diplomatic edition. I have, as before, revised the translation as carefully as I could. I have not altered Lady Guest's version in the slightest degree, but I have again put in the form of footnotes what seems to me to be a better or more literal translation. The mistranslations are fairly few in number, but some of them are quite important, such as the references to pagan baptism or to the Irish Channel. At the end of my revision, I may say that I have been struck by the comparative accuracy of the transcript of the Red Book which Lady Guest used, and by the accurate thoroughness with which she translated every one of the tales. This volume contains the oldest of the Mabinogion, the four branches of the Mabinogion proper, and the kindred tale of Lud and Lefelys. In all these we are in a perfectly pagan atmosphere, neither the introduction of Christianity nor the growth of chivalry having affected them to any extent. The story of Taliesin is the only one in the series that is not found in the Red Book of Hergest. It is taken from very much later manuscripts, and its Welsh is much more modern. Its subject, however, is akin to that of the Mabinogion proper, if, indeed, the contest between Elfin and the Bards is an echo of the contest between decaying paganism and growing Christianity. Owen Edwards. LLANUWCHLLYN, 13th September 1902. PWYLL Prince of DYVED. While, Prince of Dived, was Lord of the Seven Cantrevs of Dived, and once upon a time he was at Narberth, his chief palace, and he was minded to go and hunt, and the part of his dominions in which it pleased him to hunt was Glencutch. So he set forth from Narberth at night, and went as far as Llwyndirwyd. 11 a.m. and that night he tarried there, and early, 11 b.m. on the morrow he rose and came to Glencutch, when he let loose the dogs in the wood, and sounded the horn, and began the chase. And as he followed the dogs, he lost his companions, and whilst he listened to the hounds, he heard the cry of other hounds, a cry different from his own, and coming in the opposite direction. And he beheld a glade in the wood forming a level plain, and as his dogs came to the edge of the glade, he saw a stag before the other dogs. And lo, as it reached the middle of the glade, the dogs that followed the stag overtook it, and brought it down. Then looked he at the color of the dogs, staying not to look at the stag, and of all the hounds that he had seen in the world, he had never seen any that were like unto those. For their hair was of a brilliant shining white, and their ears were red, and as the whiteness of their bodies shone, so did the redness of their ears glisten. And he came towards the dogs, and drove away those that had brought down the stag, and set his own dogs upon it. Picture. P13.jpg. And as he was setting on his dogs, he saw a horseman coming towards him upon a large light grey steed, with a hunting horn about his neck, and clad in garments of grey woolen in the fashion of a hunting garb. And the horseman drew near and spoke unto him thus. "Chieftain," said he, "I know who thou art, and I greet thee not." "Peradventure," said Will, "thou art of such dignity that thou shouldst not do so." "Verily," answered he, "it is not my dignity that prevents me." "What is it then, O chieftain?" asked he. "By heaven, it is by reason of thine own ignorance and want of courtesy." "What discourtesy, chieftain, hast thou seen in me?" "Greater discourtesy saw I never in man," said he, "than to drive away the dogs that were killing the stag, and to set upon it thine own. This was discourteous, And though I may not be revenged upon thee, yet I declare to heaven that I will do thee more dishonor than the value of 100 stags. O chieftain, he replied, if I have done ill, I will redeem thy friendship. How wilt thou redeem it? According as thy dignity may be, but I know not who thou art. A crowned king am I in the land whence I come. Lord, said he, may the day prosper with thee, and from what land comest thou? From Unwithin, answered he, Aaron, a king of Unwithin, 13 am I. Lord, said he, how may I gain thy friendship? After this manner mayest thou, he said, there is a man whose dominions are opposite to mine, who is ever warring against me, and he is Havgan, a king of Unwithin, and by ridding me of this oppression which thou canst easily do shalt thou gain my friendship. Gladly will I do this, said he, show me how I may. I will show thee. Behold, thus it is thou mayest. I will make firm friendship with thee, and this will I do, I will send thee to Anvin in my stead, and I will give thee the fairest lady thou didst ever behold, to be thy companion, and I will put my form and semblance upon thee, so that not a page of the chamber, nor an officer, nor any other man that has always followed me shall know that it is not I, and this shall be for the space of a year from tomorrow, and then will we meet in this place. Yes, said he. But when I shall have been there for the space of a year, by what means shall I discover him of whom thou speakest? 1 year from this night, he answered, is the time fixed between him and me, that we should meet at the ford. Be thou there in my likeness, and with one stroke that thou givest him, he shall no longer live. And if he ask thee to give him another, give it not, how much soever he may entreat thee. For when I did so, he fought with me next day as well as ever before. Verily, said Will, what shall I do concerning my kingdom? Said Aaron, I will cause that no one in all thy dominions, neither man, nor woman, shall know that I am not thou, and I will go there in thy stead. Gladly then, said Will I set forward. Clear shall be thy path, and nothing shall detain thee, until thou come into my dominions, and I myself will be thy guide. So he conducted him until he came in sight of the palace and its dwellings. Behold, said he, the court and the kingdom in thy power. Enter the court, there is no one there who will know thee, and when thou sayest 15 what service is done there, thou wilt know the customs of the court. So he went forward to the court, and when he came there, he beheld sleeping rooms, and halls, and chambers, and the most beautiful buildings ever seen. And he went into the hall to disarray, and there came youths and pages and disarrayed him, and all as they entered saluted him. And two knights came and drew his hunting dress from about him, and clothed him in a vesture of silk and gold. And the hall was prepared. And behold, he saw the household and the host enter in, and the host was the most comely and the best equipped that he had ever seen. And with them came and likewise the queen, who was the fairest woman that he ever yet beheld. And she had on a yellow robe of shining satin, and they washed and went to the table, and they sat, the queen upon one side of him, and one who seemed to be an earl on the other side. And he began to speak with the queen. And he thought from her speech, that she was the seemliest, and most noble lady of converse and of cheer that ever was. And they partook of meat, and drank, with songs, and with feasting, and of all the courts upon the earth, behold, this was the best supplied with food and drink, and vessels of gold and royal jewels. *. And the year he spent in hunting, and minstrelsy, and feasting, and diversions, and discourse with his companions, until the night that was fixed for the conflict. And when that night came, it was remembered even by those who lived in the farthest part of his dominions, and he went to the meeting, and the nobles of the kingdom with him. And when he came to the ford, a knight arose and spake thus, Lords, said he, listen well. It is between two kings that this meeting is, and between them only. Each claimeth of the other his land and territory, and do all of you stand aside and leave the fight to be between them. Picture, p16.jpg. Thereupon the two kings approached each other in the middle of the ford, and encountered, and at the first thrust, the man who was in the stead of Aaron struck Havgan on the center of the boss of his shield, so that it was cloven in twain, and his armor was broken, and Havgan himself was borne to the ground an arm's and a spear's length over the crupper of his horse, and he received a deadly blow. "O chieftain," said Havgan, "what right hast thou to cause my death? I was not injuring thee in anything, and I know not wherefore thou wouldst slay me. But for the love of heaven, since thou hast begun to slay me, complete thy work." "Ah, chieftain," he replied, "I may yet repent doing that unto thee. Slay thee who may, I will not do so." 17. "My trusty lords," said Havgan, "bear me hence. My death has come. I shall be no more able to uphold you." "My nobles," also said he who was in the semblance of Aaron, "take counsel and know who ought to be my subjects." "Lord," said the nobles, "all should be, for there is no king over the whole of Anvin but thee." "Yes," he replied, "it is right that he who comes humbly should be received graciously, but he that doth not come with obedience, shall be compelled by the force of swords." And thereupon he received the homage of the men, and he began to conquer the country, and the next day by noon the two kingdoms were in his power. And thereupon he went to keep his tryst, and came to Glencoch. And when he came there, the king of Anvin was there to meet him, and each of them was rejoiced to see the other. "Verily," said Aaron, "may heaven reward thee for thy friendship towards me, I have heard of it. When thou comest thyself to thy dominions," said he, "thou wilt see that which I have done for thee. Whatever thou hast done for me, may heaven repay it thee." Then Aaron gave to Will Prince of Divad his proper form and semblance, and he himself took his own, and Aaron set forth towards the court of Anvin, and he was rejoiced when he beheld his hosts, and his household, whom he had not seen so long, but they had not known of his absence, and wondered no more at his coming than usual. And that day was spent in joy and merriment, and he sat and conversed with his wife and his nobles. And when it was time for them rather to sleep than to carouse, they went to rest. *. While Prince of Divd came likewise to his country and dominions, and began to inquire of the nobles of the land how his rule had been during the past year, compared with what it had been before. "Lord," said they, "thy wisdom was never so great, and thou wert never so kind nor so free in bestowing thy gifts, and thy justice was never more worthily seen than in this year. By heaven," said he, "for all the good you have enjoyed, you should thank him who hath been with you. For behold, thus hath this matter been." And thereupon Will related the whole unto them. "Verily, Lord," said they, "render thanks unto heaven that thou hast such a fellowship, and withhold not from us the rule which we have enjoyed for this year past." "I take heaven to witness that I will not withhold it," answered Will. And thenceforth they made strong the friendship that was between them, and each sent unto the other horses, and greyhounds, and hawks, and all such jewels as they thought would be pleasing to each other. And by reason of his having dwelt that year in Anvin, and having ruled there so prosperously, and united the two kingdoms in one day by his valor and prowess, he lost the name of Will Prince of Divad, and was called Will Chief of Anvin from that time forward. *. Once upon a time, Will was at Narberth, his chief palace, where a feast had been prepared for him, and with him was a great host of men. And after the first meal, Will rose to walk, and he went to the top of a mound that was above the palace, and was called Gors at Arberth. "Lord," said one of the court, "it is peculiar to the mound that whosoever sits upon it cannot go thence without either receiving wounds or blows, or else seeing a wonder. I fear not to receive wounds and blows in the midst of such a host as this, but as to the wonder, gladly would I see it. I will go therefore and sit upon the mound." And upon the mound he sat. And while he sat there, They saw a lady, on a pure white horse of large size, with a garment of shining gold around her, coming along the highway that led from the mound, and the horse seemed to move at a slow and even pace, and to be coming up towards the mound. "My men," said Will, "is there any among you who knows yonder lady?"
"There is not, Lord," said they.
"Go one of you and meet her, that we may know who she is." And one of them arose, and as he came upon the road to meet her, she passed by, and he followed as fast as he could, being on foot. And the greater was his speed, the further was she from him. And when he saw that it profited him nothing to follow her, he returned to Will, and said unto him, "Lord, it is idle for any one in the world to follow her on foot."
"Verily," said Will, "go unto the palace, and take the fleetest horse that thou sayest, and go after her."
And he took a horse and went forward. And he came to an open level plain, and put spurs to his horse, and the more he urged his horse, the further was she from him. Yet she held the same pace as at first, and his horse began to fail, and when his horse's feet failed him, he returned to the place where Will was.
"Lord," said he, "it will avail nothing for any one to follow yonder lady. I know of no horse in these realms swifter than this, and it availed me not to pursue her."
"Of a truth," said Will, "there must be some illusion here. Let us go towards the palace." So to the palace they went, and they spent that day. And the next day they arose, and that also they spent until it was time to go to meat. And after the first meal, "Verily," said Will, "we will go the same party as yesterday to the top of the mound." "And do thou," said he to one of his young men, "take the swiftest horse that thou knowest in the field." And thus did the young man. And they went towards the mound, taking the horse with them. And as they were sitting down they beheld the lady on the same horse, and in the same apparel, coming along the same road.
"Behold," said Will, "here is the lady of yesterday. Make ready, youth, to learn who she is."
"My lord," said he, "that will I gladly do." And thereupon the lady came opposite to them. So the youth mounted his horse, and before he had settled himself in his saddle, she passed by, and there was a clear space between them. But her speed was no greater than it had been the day before. Then he put his horse into an amble, and thought that notwithstanding the gentle pace at which his horse went, he should soon overtake her. But this availed him not. So he gave his horse the reins. And still he came no nearer to her than when he went at a foot's pace. And the more he urged his horse, the further was she from him. Yet she rode not faster than before. When he saw that it availed not to follow her, he returned to the place where Will was.
"Lord," said he, "the horse can no more than thou hast seen. I see indeed that it avails not that anyone should follow her. And by heaven," said he, "she must needs have an errand to someone in this plain, if her haste would allow her to declare it. Let us go back to the palace." And to the palace they went, and they spent that night in songs and feasting, as it pleased them. And the next day they amused themselves until it was time to go to meat. And when meat was ended, Will said, "Where are the hosts that went yesterday and the day before to the top of the mound?"
"Behold, Lord, we are here," said they.
"Let us go," said he, "to the mound, to sit there."
"And do thou," said he to the page who tended his horse, "saddle my horse well, and hasten with him to the road, and bring also my spurs with thee." And the youth did thus. And they went and sat upon the mound, and ere they had been there but a short time, they beheld the lady coming by the same road, and in the same manner, and at the same pace.
"Young man," said Will, "I see the lady coming. Give me my horse."
And no sooner had he mounted his horse than she passed him. And he turned after her and followed her. And he let his horse go bounding playfully, and thought that at the second step or the third he should come up with her. But he came no nearer to her than at first. Then he urged his horse to his utmost speed, yet he found that it availed nothing to follow her. Then said Will, "O maiden, for the sake of him whom thou best lovest,
Stay for me. I will stay gladly, said she, and it were better for thy horse hadst thou asked it long since. So the maiden stopped, and she threw back that part of her headdress which covered her face, and she fixed her eyes upon him, and began to talk with him. Lady, asked he, whence comest thou, and whereunto dost thou journey? I journey on mine own errand, said she, and right glad am I to see thee. My greeting be unto thee, said he. Then he thought that the beauty of all the maidens, and all the ladies that he had ever seen, was as nothing compared to her beauty. Lady, he said, wilt thou tell me aught concerning thy purpose? I will tell thee, said she. My chief quest was to seek thee. Behold, said Will, this is to me the most pleasing quest on which thou callest to have come, and wilt thou tell me who thou art? I will tell thee, Lord, said she, I am Rhiannon, the daughter of Heavyed Hen, and they sought to give me to a husband against my will. But no husband would I have, and that because of my love for thee, neither will I yet have one unless thou reject me. And hither have I come to hear thy answer. By heaven, said Will, behold this is my answer. If I might choose among all the ladies and damsels in the world, thee would I choose. Verily, said she, if thou art thus minded, make a pledge to meet me ere I am given to another. The sooner I may do so, the more pleasing will it be unto me, said Will, and wheresoever thou wilt, there will I meet with thee. I will that thou meet me this day 12 months at the palace of Heavyed, and I will cause a feast to be prepared, so that it be ready against thou come. Gladly, said he, will I keep this tryst. Lord, said she, remain in health, and be mindful that thou keep thy promise, and now will I go hence. So they parted, and he went back to his hosts and to them of his household. And whatsoever questions they asked him respecting the damsel, he always turned the discourse upon other matters. And when a year from that time was gone, he caused 100 knights to equip themselves and to go with him to the palace of Heavyed Hen. And he came to the palace, and there was great joy concerning him, with much concourse of people and great rejoicing, and vast preparations for his coming. And the whole court was placed under his orders. And the hall was garnished, and they went to meet, and thus did they sit. Heavyed Hen was on one side of Will, and Rhiannon on the other, and all the rest according to their rank. And they ate and feasted and talked one with another, and at the beginning of the carousal after the meat, there entered a tall auburn-haired youth, of royal bearing, clothed in a garment of satin. And when he came into the hall, he saluted Will and his companions. The greeting of heaven be unto thee, my soul, said Will, come thou and sit down. Nay, said he, a suitor am I, and I will do mine errand. Do so willingly, said Will. Lord, said he, my errand is unto thee, and it is to crave a boon of thee that I come. What boon soever thou mayest ask of me, as far as I am able, thou shalt have. Ah, said Rhiannon, wherefore didst thou give that answer? Has he not given it before the presence of these nobles? Asked the youth. My soul, said Will, what is the boon thou askest? The lady whom best I love is to be thy bride this night. I come to ask her of thee, with the feast and the banquet that are in this place. And Will was silent because of the answer which he had given. Be silent as long as thou wilt, said Rhiannon. Never did man make worse use of his wits than thou hast done. Lady, said he, I knew not who he was. Behold, this is the man to whom they would have given me against my will, said she. And he is Gwal the son of Glud, a man of great power and wealth, and because of the word thou hast spoken, bestow me upon him lest shame befall thee. Lady, said he, I understand not thine answer. Never can I do as thou sayest. Bestow me upon him, said she, and I will cause that I shall never be his. By what means will that be? Asked Will. In thy hand will I give thee a small bag, said she. See that thou keep it well, and he will ask of thee the banquet, and the feast, and the preparations which are not in thy power. Unto the host and the household will I give the feast, and such will be thy answer respecting this. And as concerns myself, I will engage to become his bride this night 12 months, and at the end of the year be thou here, said she, and bring this bag with thee, and let thy 100 nights be in the orchard up yonder. And when he is in the midst of joy and feasting, come thou in by thyself, clad in ragged garments, and holding thy bag in thy hand, and ask nothing but a bag full of food, and I will cause that if all the meat and liquor that are in these 7 cantrebs were put into it, it would be no fuller than before. And after a great deal has been put therein, he will ask thee, whether thy bag will ever be full. Say thou then that it never will, until a man of noble birth and of great wealth arise and press the food in the bag, with both his feet, saying, enough has been put therein, and I will cause him to go and tread down the food in the bag, and when he does so, turn thou the bag, so that it shall be up over his head in it, and then slip a knot upon the thongs of the bag. Let there be also a good bugle horn about thy neck, and as soon as thou hast bound him in the bag, wind thy horn, and let it be a signal between thee and thy knights. And when they hear the sound of the horn, let them come down upon the palace. Lord, said Gwal, it is meet that I have an answer to my request. As much of that thou hast asked as it is in my power to give, thou shalt have, replied Will. My soul, said Rhiannon unto him, as for the feast and the banquet that are here, I have bestowed them upon the men of Dyved, and the household, and the warriors that are with us. These can I not suffer to be given to any. In a year from tonight a banquet shall be prepared for thee in this palace, that I may become thy bride. So Gwal went forth to his possessions, and Will went also back to Dyved. And they both spent that year until it was the time for the feast at the palace of Heavy Eat Hen. Then Gwal the son of Clud set out to the feast that was prepared for him, and he came to the palace, and was received there with rejoicing. While, also, the chief of An came to the orchard with his 100 knights, as Rhiannon had commanded him, having the bag with him. And Will was clad in coarse and ragged garments, and wore large clumsy old shoes upon his feet. And when he knew that the carousal after the meat had begun, he went towards the hall, and when he came into the hall, he saluted Gwal the son of Clud, and his company, both men and women. Heaven prosper thee, said Gwal, and the greeting of heaven be unto thee. Lord, said he, may heaven reward thee, I have an errand unto thee. Welcome be thine errand, and if thou ask of me that which is just, thou shalt have it gladly. It is fitting, answered he. 26. I crave but from want, and the boon that I ask is to have this small bag that thou sayest filled with meat. A request within reason is this, said he, and gladly shalt thou have it. Bring him food. A great number of attendants arose and begun to fill the bag, but for all that they put into it, it was no fuller than at first. My soul, said Gwal, will thy bag be ever full? It will not, I declare to heaven, said he, for all that may be put into it, unless one possess of lands, and domains, and treasure, shall arise and tread down with both his feet the food that is within the bag, and shall say, enough has been put herein. Then said Rhiannon unto Gwal the son of Clud, rise up quickly. I will willingly arise, said he. So he rose up, and put his 2 feet into the bag. And Will turned up the sides of the bag, so that Gwal was over his head in it. And he shut it up quickly and slipped a knot upon the thongs, and blew his horn. And thereupon behold his household came down upon the palace. And they seized all the host that had come with Gwal, and cast them into his own prison. And Will threw off his rags, and his old shoes, and his tattered array, and as they came in, every one of Gwal's knights struck a blow upon the bag, and asked, what is here? A badger, said they. And in this manner they played, each of them striking the bag, either with his foot or with a staff. And thus played they with the bag. Every one as he came in asked, what game are you playing at thus? The game of badger in the bag, said they, and then was the game of badger in the bag first played. Lord, said the man in the bag, if thou wilt but hear me, I merit not to be slain in a bag. Said Havayad Hen, Lord, he speaks truth. It were fitting that thou listen to him, for he deserves not this. Verily, said Will, I will do thy counsel concerning him. Behold, this is my counsel then, said Rhiannon. Thou art now in a position in which it behoves thee to satisfy suitors and minstrels. Let him give unto them in thy stead, and take a pledge from him that he will never seek to revenge that which has been done to him. And this will be punishment enough. I will do this gladly, said the man in the bag. And gladly will I accept it, said Will, since it is the counsel of Heavyed and Rhiannon. Such then is our counsel, answered they. I accept it, said Will. Seek thyself sureties. We will be for him, said Heavyed, until his men be free to answer for him. And upon this he was let out of the bag, and his liegemen were liberated. Demand now of Gwal his sureties, said Heavyed. We know which should be taken for him. And Heavyed numbered the sureties. Said Gwal, do thou thyself draw up the covenant. It will suffice me that it be as Rhiannon said, answered Will. So unto that covenant were the sureties pledged. Verily, Lord, said Gwal, I am greatly hurt, and I have many bruises. I have need to be anointed. With thy leave I will go forth. I will leave nobles in my stead, to answer for me in all that thou shalt require. Willingly, said Will, mayest thou do thus. So Gwal went towards his own possessions. And the hall was set in order for Will and the men of his host, and for them also of the palace, and they went to the tables and sat down. And as they had sat that time 12 months, so sat they that night. And they eat, and feasted, and spent the night in mirth and tranquility. And the time came that they should sleep, and Will and Rhiannon went to their chamber. And next morning at the break of day, my lord, said Rhiannon, arise and begin to give thy gifts unto the minstrels. Refuse no one today that may claim thy bounty. Thus shall it be gladly, said Will, both today and every day while the feast shall last. So Will arose, and he caused silence to be proclaimed, and desired all the suitors and the minstrels to show and to point out what gifts were to their wish and desire. 28 And this being done, the feast went on, and he denied no one while it lasted. And when the feast was ended, Will said unto Heavyed, my lord, with thy permission I will set out for Divad tomorrow. Certainly, said Heavyed, may heaven prosper thee. Fix also a time when Rhiannon may follow thee. By heaven, said Will, we will go hence together. Wiliest thou this, lord? Said Heavyed. Yes, by heaven, answered Will. And the next day, they set forward towards Divad, and journeyed to the palace of Narberth, where a feast was made ready for them. And there came to them great numbers of the chief men and the most noble ladies of the land, and of these there were none to whom Rhiannon did not give some rich gift, either a bracelet, or a ring, or a precious stone. And they ruled the land prosperously both that year and the next. And in the third year the nobles of the land began to be sorrowful at seeing a man whom they loved so much, and who was moreover their lord and their foster brother, without an heir. And they came to him. 29 And the place where they met was Presaluoy, in Dived. Lord, said they, we know that thou art not so young as some of the men of this country, and we fear that thou mayest not have an heir of the wife whom thou hast taken. Take therefore another wife of whom thou mayest have heirs. Thou canst not always continue with us, and though thou desire to remain as thou art, we will not suffer thee. Truly, said Will, we have not long been joined together, and many things may yet befall. Grant me a year from this time, and for the space of a year we will abide together, and after that I will do according to your wishes. So they granted it, and before the end of a year a son was born unto him. And in Narberth was he born, and on the night that he was born, women were brought to watch the mother and the boy. and the women slept, as did also Rhiannon, the mother of the boy. And the number of the women that were brought into the chamber was 6. And they watched for a good portion of the night, and before midnight every one of them fell asleep, and towards break of day they awoke. And when they awoke, they looked where they had put the boy, and behold, he was not there. "Oh," said one of the women, "the boy is lost."
"Yes," said another, "and it will be small vengeance if we are burned or put to death because of the child."
Said one of the women, "Is there any counsel for us in the world in this matter?"
"There is," answered another. "I offer you good counsel."
"What is that?"
asked they.
"There is here a staghound bitch, and she has a litter of whelps. Let us kill some of the cubs, and rub the blood on the face and hands of Rhiannon, and lay the bones before her, and assert that she herself had devoured her son, and she alone will not be able to gainsay us 6. And according to this counsel it was settled. And towards morning Rhiannon awoke, and she said, "Women, where is my son?"
"Lady," said they, "ask us not concerning thy son. We have naught but the blows and the bruises we got by struggling with thee, and of a truth we never saw any woman so violent as thou, for it was of no avail to contend with thee. Hast thou not thyself devoured thy son? Claim him not therefore of us."
"For pity's sake," said Rhiannon, "the Lord God knows all things. Charge me not falsely.
30. If you tell me this from fear, I assert before heaven that I will defend you."
"Truly," said they, "we would not bring evil on ourselves for any one in the world."
"For pity's sake," said Rhiannon, "you will receive no evil by telling the truth." But for all her words, whether fair or harsh, 31a, she received but the same answer from the women. And Will the chief of Anvin arose, and his household, and his hosts. And this occurrence could not be concealed, but the story went forth throughout the land, and all the nobles heard it. Then the nobles came to Will, and besought him to put away his wife, because of the great, 31b, crime which she had done. But Will answered them, that they had no cause wherefore they might ask him to put away his wife, save for her having no children. But children has she now had, therefore will I not put her away. If she has done wrong, let her do penance for it. So Rhiannon sent for the teachers and the wise men, and as she preferred doing penance to contending with the women, she took upon her a penance. And the penance that was imposed upon her was, that she should remain in that palace of Narberth until the end of 7 years, and that she should sit every day near unto a horse block that was without the gate, and that she should relate the story to all who should come there, whom she might suppose not to know it already, and that she should offer the guests and strangers, if they would permit her, to carry them upon her back into the palace. But it rarely happened that any would permit. And thus did she spend part of the year. Now at that time Tarnion Trivlant was lord of Gwent's Coed, and he was the best man in the world. And unto his house there belonged a mare, than which neither mare nor horse in the kingdom was more beautiful. And on the night of every 1st of May she foaled, and no one ever knew what became of the colt. And one night Tarnion talked with his wife. "Wife," said he, "it is very simple of us that our mare should foal every year, and that we should have none of her colts. What can be done in the matter?" Said she. "This is the night of the 1st of May," said he. "The vengeance of heaven be upon me, if I learn not what it is that takes away the colts." So he caused the mare to be brought into a house, and he armed himself, and began to watch that night. And in the beginning of the night, the mare foaled a large and beautiful colt, and it was standing up in the place. And Tarnion rose up and looked at the size of the colt, and as he did so he heard a great tumult, and after the tumult behold a claw came through the window into the house, and it seized the colt by the mane. Then Tarnion drew his sword, and struck off the arm at the elbow, so that portion of the arm together with the colt was in the house with him. And then did he hear a tumult and wailing, both at once. And he opened the door, and rushed out in the direction of the noise, and he could not see the cause of the tumult, because of the darkness of the night,
but he rushed after it and followed it. Then he remembered that he had left the door open, and he returned. And at the door, behold, there was an infant boy in swaddling clothes, wrapped around in a mantle of satin. And he took up the boy, and behold, he was very strong for the age that he was of. Then he shut the door, and went unto the chamber where his wife was. "Lady," said he, "art thou sleeping?"
"No, Lord," said she, "I was asleep, but as thou camest and I did awake. Behold, here is a boy for thee if thou wilt," said he, "since thou hast never had one."
"My lord," said she, "what adventure is this?"
"It was thus," said Taranyon, and he told her how it all befell.
"Verily, lord," said she, "what sort of garments are there upon the boy?"
"A mantle of satin," said he.
"He is then a boy of gentle lineage," she replied.
"My lord," she said, "if thou wilt, I shall have great diversion and mirth. I will call my women unto me, and tell them that I have been pregnant."
"I will readily grant thee to do this," he answered, and thus did they, and they caused the boy to be baptized, and the ceremony was performed there.
33. And the name which they gave unto him was Grewalt Urin, because whate'er was upon his head was as yellow as gold. And they had the boy nursed in the court until he was a year old. And before the year was over, he could walk stoutly. And he was larger than a boy of 3 years old, even one of great growth and size. And the boy was nursed the second year, and then he was as large as a child 6 years old. And before the end of the fourth year, he would bribe the grooms to allow him to take the horses to water.
"My lord," said his wife unto Taranyon, "where is the colt which thou didst save on the night that thou foundest the boy?"
"I have commanded the grooms of the horses," said he, "that they take care of him."
"Would it not be well, lord," said she, "if thou were to cause him to be broken in, and given to the boy, seeing that on the same night that thou didst find the boy, the colt was foaled and thou didst save him?"
"I will not oppose thee in this matter," said Taranyon.
"I will allow thee to give him the colt."
"Lord," said she, "may heaven reward thee, I will give it him." So the horse was given to the boy. Then she went to the grooms and those who tended the horses, and commanded them to be careful of the horse, so that he might be broken in by the time that the boy could ride him. And while these things were going forward, they heard tidings of Rhiannon and her punishment. And Taranyon driv-lined, by reason of the pity that he felt on hearing this story of Rhiannon, and her punishment, and inquired closely concerning it, until he had heard from many of those who came to his court. Then did Taranyon, often lamenting the sad history, ponder within himself, and he looked steadfastly on the boy, and as he looked upon him, it seemed to him that he had never beheld so great a likeness between father and son, as between the boy and Bwill, the chief of Anvin. Now the semblance of Bwill was well known to him, for he had of yore been one of his followers. And thereupon he became grieved for the wrong that he did, in keeping with him a boy whom he knew to be the son of another man. And the first time that he was alone with his wife, he told her, that it was not right that they should keep the boy with them, and suffer so excellent a lady as Rhiannon to be punished so greatly on his account, whereas the boy was the son of Bwill, the chief of Anvin. And Taranyon's wife agreed with him, that they should send the boy to Bwill.
"And three things, lord," said she, "shall we gain thereby: thanks and gifts for releasing Rhiannon from her punishment, and thanks from Bwill, for nursing his son, and restoring him unto him, and thirdly, if the boy is of gentle nature, he will be our foster son, and he will do for us all the good in his power." So it was settled according to this counsel. And no later than the next day was Taranyon equipped, and two other knights with him. And the boy, as a fourth in their company, went with them upon the horse which Taranyon had given him. And they journeyed towards Narberth, and it was not long before they reached that place. And as they drew near to the palace, they beheld Rhiannon sitting beside the horse block. And when they were opposite to her, "Chieftain," said she, "go not further thus, I will bear every one of you into the palace, and this is my penance for slaying my own son and devouring him.
O fair lady, said Terenyun, think not that I will be one to be carried upon my back.
Neither will I, said the boy.
Truly, my soul, said Terenyun, we will not go.
35 So they went forward to the palace, and there was great joy at their coming. And at the palace a feast was prepared, because Bwil was come back from the confines of Dived. And they went into the hall and washed, and Bwil rejoiced to see Terenyun. And in this order they sat, Terenyun between Bwil and Rhiannon, and Terenyon's two companions on the other side of Bwil, with the boy between them. And after meat they began to carouse and to discourse. And Terenyon's discourse was concerning the adventure of the mayor and the boy, and how he and his wife had nursed and reared the child as their own.
And behold, here is thy son, lady, said Terenyun. And whosoever told that lie concerning thee, has done wrong.
And when I heard of thy sorrow, I was troubled and grieved. And I believe that there is none of this host who will not perceive that the boy is the son of Bwil, said Terenyun.
There is none, said they all, who is not certain thereof.
I declare to heaven, said Rhiannon, that if this be true, there indeed is an end to my trouble.
36 A lady, said Penderyn Dyved, well hast thou named thy son Pryderi, and well becomes him the name of Pryderi, son of Bwil, chief of Anvin.
Look you, said Rhiannon, will not his own name become him better?
What name has he? Asked Penderyn Dyved.
Grewalt Urin is the name that we gave him.
Pryderi, said Penderyn, shall his name be.
It were more proper, said Bwil, that the boy should take his name from the word his mother spoke when she received the joyful tidings of him. And thus was it arranged.
Terenyun, said Bwil, heaven reward thee that thou hast reared the boy up to this time, and, being of gentle lineage,
36b, it were fitting that he repay thee for it.
My lord, said Terenyun, it was my wife who nursed him, and there is no one in the world so afflicted as she at parting with him.
It were well that he should bear in mind what I and my wife have done for him.
I call heaven to witness, said Bwil, that while I live I will support thee in thy possessions, as long as I am able to preserve my own. And when he shall have power, he will more fitly maintain them than I.
37 A. And if this counsel be pleasing unto thee, and to my nobles, it shall be that, as thou hast reared him up to the present time, I will give him to be brought up by Penderyn Dyved, from henceforth. And you shall be companions and shall both be foster fathers unto him.
This is good counsel, said they all.
So the boy was given to Penderyn Dyved, and the nobles of the land were sent with him. And Terenyun Drivlyant, and his companions, set out for his country, and his possessions, with love and gladness. And he went not without being offered the fairest jewels and the fairest horses and the choicest dogs, but he would take none of them.
Thereupon they all remained in their own dominions. And Pryderi, the son of Bwil, the chief of Anvin, was brought up carefully as was fit, so that he became the fairest youth, and the most comely, and the best skilled in all good games, of any in the kingdom. And thus passed years and years, until the end of Bwil, the chief of Anvin's life came, and he died. And Pryderi ruled the 7 cantrevs of Dyved prosperously, and he was beloved by his people, and by all around him. And at length, 37b, he added unto them the 3 cantrevs of Istradtywy and the 4 cantrevs of Cardigan, and these were called the 7 cantrevs of Syisilwk. And when he made this addition, Pryderi the son of Bwil, the chief of Anvin, desired to take a wife. And the wife he chose was Kikva, the daughter of Gwyngohoywa, the son of Gloywalalt, 38 Lydon, the son of Prince Kasner, one of the nobles of this island. And thus ends this portion of the Mabinogion.
Picture, p38.jpg, Branwen the daughter of Llyr. Picture, p39.jpg, Benugiadvran, the son of Lir was the crowned king of this island,
and he was exalted from the crown of London. 39 A. And one afternoon he was at Harlech and arted we, at his court, and he sat upon the rock of Harlech, looking over the sea. 39 B. And with him were his brother Manawydan the son of Lear, and his brothers by the mother's side, Nisshiain and Athnisshiain, and many nobles likewise, as was fitting to see around a king. His two brothers by the mother's side were the sons of Euroswyd, by his mother, Penardun, 40, the daughter of Beli son of Manogan. And one of these youths was a good youth and of gentle nature, and would make peace between his kindred and cause his family to be friends when their wrath was at the highest, and this one was Nisshiain. But the other would cause strife between his two brothers when they were most at peace. And as they sat thus, they beheld 13 ships coming from the south of Ireland, and making towards them, and they come with a swift motion, the wind being behind them, and they neared them rapidly. "I see ships afar," said the king, "coming swiftly towards the land. Command the men of the court that they equip themselves, and go and learn their intent." So the men equipped themselves and went down towards them. And when they saw the ships near, certain were they that they had never seen ships better furnished. Beautiful flags of satin were upon them. And behold, one of the ships outstripped the others, and they saw a shield lifted up above the side of the ship, and the point of the shield was upwards, in token of peace. And the men drew near that they might hold converse. Then they put out boats and came towards the land. And they saluted the king. Now the king could hear them from the place where he was, upon the rock above their heads. "Heaven prosper you," said he, "and be welcome. To whom do these ships belong, and who is the chief amongst you?"
"Lord," said they, "Matholwch, king of Ireland, is here, and these ships belong to him."
"Wherefore comes he?" asked the king, "and will he come to the land?"
"He is a suitor unto thee, Lord," said they, "and he will not land unless he have his boon."
"And what may that be?" inquired the king.
"He desires to ally himself with thee, Lord," said they, "and he comes to ask Branwen, the daughter of Lear, that, if it seem well to thee, the island of the mighty may be leagued with Ireland and both become more powerful."
"Verily," said he, "let him come to land, and we will take counsel thereupon." And this answer was brought to Matholwch.
"I will go willingly," said he. So he landed, and they received him joyfully, and great was the throng in the palace that night, between his hosts and those of the court, and next day they took counsel, and they resolved to bestow Branwen upon Matholwch. Now she was one of the three chief ladies of this island, and she was the fairest damsel in the world. And they fixed upon Aberfra, as the place where she should become his bride. And they went thence, and towards Aberfra the hosts proceeded, Matholwch and his host in their ships, Bendigeidvran and his host by land, until they came to Aberfra. And at Aberfra they began to feast and sat down. And thus sat they, the king of the island of the mighty and Manawydan the son of Lear, on one side, and Matholwch on the other side, and Branwen the daughter of Lear beside him. And they were not within a house, but under tents. No house could ever contain Bendigeidvran. And they began the banquet and caroused and discoursed. And when it was more pleasing to them to sleep than to carouse, they went to rest, and that night Branwen became Matholwch's bride. And next day they arose, and all they of the court, and the officers began to equip and to range the horses and the attendants, and they ranged them in order as far as the sea. And behold, one day, Evnishian, the quarrelsome man of whom it is spoken above, came by chance into the place where the horses of Matholwch were, and asked whose horses they might be. "They are the horses of Matholwch, king of Ireland, who is married to Branwen, thy sister. His horses are they. And is it thus they have done with a maiden such as she, and moreover my sister, bestowing her without my consent? They could have offered no greater insult to me than this," said he. And thereupon he rushed under the horses and cut off their lips at the teeth, and their ears close to their heads, and their tails, 42, close to their backs,
and wherever he could clutch their eyelids, he cut them to the very bone, and he disfigured the horses and rendered them useless. And they come with these tidings unto Matholwch, saying that the horses were disfigured, and injured so that not one of them could ever be of any use again. "Verily, Lord," said one, "it was an insult unto thee, and as such was it meant. Of a truth, it is a marvel to me, that if they desire to insult me, they should have given me a maiden of such high rank and so much beloved of her kindred, as they have done." "Lord," said another, "thou sayest that thus it is, and there is nothing for thee to do but to go to thy ships." And thereupon towards his ships he set out. And tidings came to Bendigeidvran that Matholwch was quitting the court without asking leave, and messengers were sent to inquire of him wherefore he did so. And the messengers that went were Idoc the son of Anarod, and Heviid Hur. And these overtook him and asked of him what he designed to do, and wherefore he went forth. "Of a truth," said he, "if I had known, I had not come hither. I have been altogether insulted. No one had ever worse treatment than I have had here. But one thing surprises me above all."
"What is that?"
asked they. "That Branwen, the daughter of Lear, one of the three chief ladies of this island, and the daughter of the king of the Island of the Mighty, should have been given me as my bride, and that after that I should have been insulted, and I marvel that the insult was not done me before they had bestowed upon me a maiden so exalted as she." "Truly, Lord, it was not the will of any that are of the court," said they, "nor of any that are of the council, that thou shouldst have received this insult, and as thou hast been insulted, the dishonor is greater unto Bendigeidvran than unto thee."
"Verily," said he, "I think so. Nevertheless, he cannot recall the insult."
These men returned with that answer to the place where Bendigeidvran was, and they told him what reply Matholwch had given them. "Truly," said he, "there are no means by which we may prevent his going away at enmity with us, that we will not take."
"Well, Lord," said they, "send after him another embassy."
"I will do so," said he. "Arise, Menawidan son of Lear, and Heviid Hur, and eunuch Glewiskwyd, and go after him, and tell him that he shall have a sound horse for every one that has been injured. And beside that, as an atonement for the insult, he shall have a staff of silver, as large and as tall as himself, and a plate of gold of the breadth of his face. And show unto him who it was that did this, and that it was done against my will, but that he who did it is my brother, by the mother's side, and therefore it would be hard for me to put him to death. And let him come and meet me," said he, "and we will make peace in any way he may desire." The embassy went after Matholwch, and told him all these sayings in a friendly manner, and he listened thereunto.
"Men," said he, "I will take counsel." So to the council he went. And in the council they considered that if they should refuse this, they were likely to have more shame rather than to obtain so great an atonement. They resolved therefore to accept it, and they returned to the court in peace. Then the pavilions in the tents were set in order after the fashion of a hall, and they went to meat, and as they had sat at the beginning of the feast, so sat they there. And Matholwch and Bendigeidvran began to discourse, and behold, it seemed to Bendigeidvran, while they talked, that Matholwch was not so cheerful as he had been before. And he thought that the chieftain might be sad because of the smallness of the atonement which he had for the wrong that had been done him.
"O man," said Bendigeidvran, "thou dost not discourse tonight so cheerfully as thou wert wont. And if it be because of the smallness of the atonement, thou shalt add thereunto whatsoever thou mayest choose, and tomorrow I will pay thee the horses."
"Lord," said he, "heaven reward thee."
"And I will enhance the atonement," said Bendigeidvran, "for I will give unto thee a cauldron, the property of which is, that if one of thy men be slain today, and be cast therein, tomorrow he will be as well as ever he was at the best, except that he will not regain his speech." And thereupon he gave him great thanks, and very joyful was he for that cause. And the next morning they paid Matholwch the horses as long as the trained horses lasted,
and then they journeyed into another comet, where they paid him with colts until the whole had been paid, and from thenceforth the comet was called Talabolian. Picture, p46.jpg. And a second night sat they together. My lord, said Matholic, whence hadst thou the cauldron which thou hast given me? I had lit of a man who had been in thy land, said he, and I would not give it except to one from there. 45. Who was it? Asked he. Lasser Leas Jivnid. He came here from Ireland, with Comaduke Mineville, his wife, who escaped from the iron house in Ireland, when it was made red hot around them, and fled hither. And it is a marvel to me that thou shouldst know nothing concerning the matter. Something I do know, said he, and as much as I know I will tell thee. One day I was hunting in Ireland, and I came to the mound at the head of the lake, which is called the Lake of the Cauldron. And I beheld a huge yellow-haired man coming from the lake with a cauldron upon his back. And he was a man of vast size, and of horrid aspect, and a woman followed after him. And if the man was tall, twice as large as he was the woman, and they came towards me and greeted me. Verily, asked I, wherefore are you journeying? Behold this, said he to me, is the cause that we journey. At the end of a month and a fortnight this woman will have a son, and the child that will be born at the end of the month and the fortnight will be a warrior fully armed. So I took them with me, and maintained them. And they were with me for a year. And that year I had them with me not grudgingly. But thenceforth was their murmuring, because that they were with me. For from the beginning of the fourth month they had begun to make themselves hated and to be disorderly in the land, committing outrages, and molesting and harassing the nobles and ladies. And thenceforward my people rose up and besought me to part with them, and they bade me to choose between them and my dominions. And I applied to the council of my country to know what should be done concerning them, for of their own free will they would not go, neither could they be compelled against their will, through fighting. And, the people of the country, being in this strait, they caused a chamber to be made all of iron. Now when the chamber was ready, there came there every smith that was in Ireland, and every one who owned tongs and hammer. And they caused coals to be piled up as high as the top of the chamber. And they had the man, and the woman, and the children, served with plenty of meat and drink. But when it was known that they were drunk, they began to put fire to the coals about the chamber, and they blew it with bellows until the house was red hot all around them. Then was there a council held in the center of the floor of the chamber. And the man tarried until the plates of iron were all of a white heat. And then, by reason of the great heat, the man dashed against the plates with his shoulder and struck them out, and his wife followed him. But except him and his wife, none escaped thence. And then I suppose, Lord, said Matholic unto Bendigeidvren, that he came over unto thee. Doubtless he came here, said he, and gave unto me the cauldron. In what manner didst thou receive them? I dispersed them through every part of my dominions, and they have become numerous and are prospering everywhere, and they fortify the places where they are with men and arms, of the best that were ever seen. That night they continued to discourse as much as they would, and had minstrelsy and carousing, and when it was more pleasant to them to sleep than to sit longer, they went to rest. And thus was the banquet carried on with joyousness, and when it was finished, Matholic journeyed towards Ireland, and Bran went with him, and they went from Abermeni with 13 ships and came to Ireland. And in Ireland was there great joy because of their coming. And not one great man or noble lady visited Bran when unto whom she gave not either a clasp, or ring, or royal jewel to keep, such as it was honorable to be seen departing with. And in these things she spent that year in much renown, and she passed her time pleasant, enjoying honor and friendship. And in the meanwhile, it chanced that she became pregnant, and in due time a son was born unto her, and the name that they gave him was Gwern, the son of Matholic, and they put the boy out to be foster nursed, in a place where were the best men of Ireland. And behold, in the second year a tumult arose in Ireland,
on account of the insult which Matholwch had received in Wales, and the payment made him for his horses, and his foster brothers, and such as were nearest unto him, blamed him openly, 48a, for that matter, and he might have no peace by reason of the tumult until they should revenge upon him this disgrace. And the vengeance which they took was to drive away Branwen from the same chamber with him, and to make her cook, 48b, for the court, and they caused the butcher, after he had cut up the meat, to come to her and give her every day a blow on the ear, and such they made her punishment. Verily, Lord, said his men to Matholwch, forbid now the ships and the ferry boats and the coracles, that they go not into Wales, and such as come over from Wales hither, imprison them that they go not back for this thing to be known there. And they did so, and it was thus for no less than 3 years. Picture, p49.jpg. And Branwen reared a starling in the cover of the kneading trough, and she taught it to speak, and she taught the bird what manner of man her brother was, and she wrote a letter of her woes, and the despite with which she was treated, and she bound the letter to the root of the bird's wing, and sent it towards Wales, and the bird came to this island, and one day it found Bendigeidvran at Caersiand in Arvin, conferring there, and it alighted upon his shoulder and ruffled its feathers, so that the letter was seen, and they knew that the bird had been reared in a domestic manner. Then Bendigeidvran took the letter and looked upon it. And when he had read the letter, he grieved exceedingly at the tidings of Branwen's woes. And immediately he began sending messengers to summon the island together. And he caused 74 countries to come unto him, and he complained to them himself of the grief that his sister endured. So they took counsel. And in the council they resolved to go to Ireland, and to leave 7 men as princes here, and Caradoc the son of Bran, as the chief of them, and their 7 knights. In Edeirinion, were these men left, and for this reason were the 7 knights placed in the town. 58 Now the names of these 7 were Caradoc the son of Bran, and Helviedher, and Eunuch Luisquid, and Idic the son of Anarok Gwaldgrin, and Fodor the son of Ervil, and Gwlch Minisgrin, and Lasser the son of Laser Lasgigwid, and Penderin Divet as a young page with them. And these abode as 7 ministers to take charge of this island, and Caradoc the son of Bran was the chief amongst them. Bendigeidvran, with the hosts of which we spoke, sailed towards Ireland, and it was not far across the sea, and he came to shoal water. It was but by 2 rivers, the Lee and the Archon were they called, and the nations covered the sea. 50b Then he proceeded with what provisions he had on his own back, and approached the shore of Ireland. Now the swineherds of Matholwch were upon the seashore, and they came to Matholwch. Lord, said they, greeting be unto thee. Heaven protect you, said he, have you any news? Lord, said they, we have marvellous news. A wood have we seen upon the sea, in a place where we never yet saw a single tree. This is indeed a marvel, said he. Saw you aught else? We saw, Lord, said they, a vast mountain beside the wood, which moved, and there was a lofty ridge on the top of the mountain, and a lake on each side of the ridge. And the wood, and the mountain, and all these things moved. Verily, said he, there is none who can know aught concerning this, unless it be Branwen. Messengers then went unto Branwen. Lady, said they, what thinkest thou that this is? The men of the island of the mighty, who have come hither on hearing of my ill treatment and my woes. What is the forest that is seen upon the sea? Asked they. The yards and the masts of ships, she answered. Alas, said they, what is the mountain that is seen by the side of the ships? Bendigeidvran, my brother, she replied, coming to shoal water, there is no ship that can contain him in it. What is the lofty ridge with the lake on each side thereof? On looking towards this island he is wroth, and his 2 eyes on each side of his nose are the 2 lakes on each side of the ridge. The warriors and chief men of Ireland were brought together in haste, and they took counsel. Lord,
said the nobles unto Matholic, there is no other counsel than to retreat over the Leenon, a river which is 52 a in Ireland, and to keep the river between thee and him, and to break down the bridge that is across the river, for there is a low stone at the bottom of the river that neither ship nor vessel can pass over. So they retreated across the river, and broke down the bridge. Bendigeidvran came to land, and the fleet with him by the bank of the river. Lord, said his chieftains, knowest thou the nature of this river, that nothing can go across it, and there is no bridge over it? What, said they, is thy counsel concerning a bridge? There is none, said he, except that he who will be chief let him be a bridge. I will be so, said he, and then was that saying first uttered, and it is still used as a proverb. And when he had lain down across the river, hurdles were placed upon him, and the host passed over thereby. And as he rose up, behold, the messengers of Matholic came to him, and saluted him, and gave him greeting in the name of Matholic, his kinsman, and showed how that of his good will he had merited of him nothing but good. For Matholic has given the kingdom of Ireland to Gwern the son of Matholic, thy nephew and thy sister's son. And this he places before thee, as a compensation for the wrong and despite that has been done unto Branwen. And Matholic shall be maintained wheresoever thou wilt, either here or in the island of the mighty. Said Bendigeidvran, shall not I myself have the kingdom? 52b Then peradventure I may take counsel concerning your message. From this time until then no other answer will you get from me. Verily, said they, the best message that we receive for thee, we will convey it unto thee, and do thou await our message unto him. I will wait, answered he, and do you return quickly. The messengers set forth and came to Matholic. Lord, said they, prepare a better message for Bendigeidvran. He would not listen at all to the message that we bore him. My friends, said Matholic, what may be your counsel? Lord, said they, there is no other counsel than this alone. He was never known to be within a house. Make therefore a house that will contain him and the men of the island of the mighty on the one side, and thyself and thy host on the other, and give over thy kingdom to his will, and do him homage. So by reason of the honor thou do him in making him a house, whereas he never before had a house to contain him, he will make peace with thee. So the messengers went back to Bendigeidvran, bearing him this message. And he took counsel, and in the council it was resolved that he should accept this, and this was all done by the advice of Branwen, and lest the country should be destroyed. And this peace was made, and the house was built both vast and strong. But the Irish planned a crafty device, and the craft was that they should put brackets on each side of the 100 pillars that were in the house, and should place a leathern bag on each bracket, and an armed man in every one of them. Then a vision came in before the host of the island of the mighty, and scanned the house with fierce and savage looks, and descried the leathern bags which were around the pillars. What is in this bag? Asked he of one of the Irish. Meal, good soul, said he, and Avnisian felt about it until he came to the man's head, and he squeezed the head until he felt his fingers meet together in the brain through the bone. And he left that one and put his hand upon another, and asked what was therein? Meal, said the Irishman. So he did the like unto every one of them, until he had not left alive of all the 200 men save one only, and when he came to him, he asked what was there? Meal, good soul, said the Irishman. And he felt about until he felt the head, and he squeezed the head as he had done the others. And albeit he found that the head of this one was armed, he left him not until he had killed him. And then he sang an anglin. There is in this bag a different sort of meal, the ready combatant, when the assault is made by his fellow warriors, prepared for battle. Thereupon came the hosts unto the house. The men of the island of Ireland entered the house on the one side, and the men of the island of the mighty on the other. And as soon as they had sat down, there was concord between them, and the sovereignty was conferred upon the boy. When the peace was concluded,
Bendigeidvran called the boy unto him, and from Bendigeidvran the boy went unto Manawydan, and he was beloved by all that beheld him. And from Manawydan the boy was called by Nishian the son of Euroswid, and the boy went unto him lovingly. Wherefore, said Ifnishian, comes not my nephew the son of my sister unto me? Though he were not king of Ireland, yet willingly would I fondle the boy. Cheerfully let him go to thee, said Bendigeidvran, and the boy went unto him cheerfully. By my confession to heaven, said Ifnishian in his heart, unthought of by the household is the slaughter that I will this instant commit. Then he arose and took up the boy by the feet, and before anyone in the house could seize hold of him, he thrust the boy headlong into the blazing fire. And when Branwen saw her son burning in the fire, she strove to leap into the fire also, from the place where she sat between her two brothers. But Bendigeidvran grasped her with one hand, and his shield with the other. Then they all hurried about the house, and never was there made so great a tumult by any host in one house as was made by them, as each man armed himself. Then said Mordwidtilion, the gadflies of Mordwidtilion's cow. And while they all sought their arms, Bendigeidvran supported Branwen between his shield and his shoulder. Then the Irish kindled a fire under the cauldron of renovation, and they cast the dead bodies into the cauldron until it was full, and the next day they came forth fighting men as good as before, except that they were not able to speak. Then when Ifnishian saw the dead bodies of the men of the island of the mighty nowhere resuscitated, he said in his heart, alas! Woe is me, that I should have been the cause of bringing the men of the island of the mighty into so great a strait. Evil betide me if I find not a deliverance therefrom. And he cast himself among the dead bodies of the Irish, and two unshod Irishmen came to him, and, taking him to be one of the Irish, flung him into the cauldron. And he stretched himself out in the cauldron, so that he rent the cauldron into four pieces, and burst his own heart also. In consequence of that, the men of the island of the mighty obtained such success as they had, but they were not victorious, for only seven men of them all escaped, and Bendigeidvran himself was wounded in the foot with a poisoned dart. Now the seven men that escaped were Prideri, Manoidan, Glunyu, 56 A. Ildaran, Taliesin, Einok, Grodiain, 56 B. the son of Muriel, and Heilin the son of Gwynhen. And Bendigeidvran commanded them that they should cut off his head. And take you my head, said he, and bear it even unto the White Mount, in London, and bury it there, with the face towards France. And a long time will you be upon the road. In Harlech you will be feasting 7 years, the birds of Rhiannon singing unto you the while. And all that time the head will be to you as pleasant company as it ever was when on my body. And at Gwales in Penvroe you will be 80 years, and you may remain there, and the head with you uncorrupted, until you open the door that looks towards Aberhenvillen, and towards Cornwall. And after you have opened that door, there you may no longer tarry, set forth then to London to bury the head and go straight forward. So they cut off his head, and these seven went forward therewith. And Branwen was the eighth with them, and they came to land at Aberallaw, in Tailwillian, and they sat down to rest. And Branwen looked towards Ireland and towards the island of the mighty, to see if she could descry them. Alas, said she, woe is me that I was ever born! Two islands have been destroyed because of me. Then she uttered a loud groan, and there broke her heart. And they made her a four-sided grave and buried her upon the banks of the Allaw. Then the seven men journeyed forward towards Harlech, bearing the head with them. And as they went, behold, there met them a multitude of men and of women. Have you any tidings? Asked Manawydan. We have none, said they, save that Caswellan, the son of Beli, has conquered the island of the mighty, and is crowned king in London. What has become, said they, of Caradoc the son of Bran, and the seven men who were left with him in this island? Caswellan came upon them, and slew six of the men,
and Caradoc's heart broke for grief thereof, for he could see the sword that slew the men, but knew not who it was that wielded it. Kjwalon had flung upon him the veil of illusion, so that no one could see him slay the men, but the sword only could they see. And it liked him not to slay Caradoc, because he was his nephew, the son of his cousin. And now he was the third whose heart had broke through grief. Pender and Dived, who had remained as a young page with these men, escaped into the wood, said they. Then they went on to Harlech, and there stopped to rest, and they provided meat and liquor, and sat down to eat and to drink. And there came three birds, and began singing unto them a certain song, and all the songs they had ever heard were unpleasant compared thereto, and the birds seemed to them to be at a great distance from them over the sea, yet they appeared as distinct as if they were close by, and at this repast they continued 7 years. And at the close of the seventh year, they went forth to Gwales in Penbrough, and there they found a fair and regal spot overlooking the ocean, and a spacious hall was therein, and they went into the hall, and two of its doors were open, but the third door was closed, that which looked towards Cornwall. "See, yonder," said Manawydan, "is the door that we may not open." And that night they regaled themselves and were joyful. And of all they had seen of food laid before them, and of all they had heard of, they remembered nothing, neither of that, nor of any sorrow whatsoever. And there they remained 80 years, unconscious of having ever spent a time more joyous and mirthful. And they were not more weary than when first they came, neither did they, any of them, know the time they had been there. And it was not more irksome to them having the head with them, than if Bendigeidvran had been with them himself. And because of these 80 years, it was called the entertaining of the noble head. The entertaining of Branwen and Matholwick was in the time that they went to Ireland. "One day," said Hialin, the son of Gwyn, "evil betide me, if I do not open the door to know if that is true which is said concerning it." So he opened the door and looked towards Cornwall and Aberhanvilan. And when they had looked, they were as conscious of all the evils they had ever sustained, and of all the friends and companions they had lost, and of all the misery that had befallen them, as if all had happened in that very spot. 59a And especially of the fate of their lord. And because of their perturbation they could not rest. 59b But journeyed forth with the head towards London. And they buried the head in the White Mount, and when it was buried, this was the third goodly concealment, and it was the third ill-fated disclosure when it was disinterred, inasmuch as no invasion from across the sea came to this island, while the head was in that concealment. And thus is the story related of those who journeyed over from Ireland. In Ireland none were left alive, except 5 pregnant women in a cave in the Irish wilderness, and to these 5 women in the same night were born 5 sons, whom they nursed until they became grown-up youths. And they thought about wives, and they at the same time desired to possess them, and each took a wife of the mothers of their companions, and they governed the country and peopled it. And these 5 divided it amongst them. And because of this partition are the 5 divisions of Ireland still so termed. And they examined the land where the battles had taken place, and they found gold and silver until they became wealthy. And thus ends this portion of the Mabinogi, concerning the blow given to Branwen, which was the third unhappy blow of this island, and concerning the entertainment of Bran, when the hosts of 70 countries and 10 went over to Ireland, to revenge the blow given to Branwen, and concerning the 7 years' banquet in Harlech, and the singing of the birds of Rhiannon, and the sojourning of the head for the space of 80 years. Picture P60.jpg. Manawydan, the son of Llyr. Picture P61.jpg. When the 7 men of whom we spoke above had buried the head of Bendigeidvran in the White Mount in London, with its face towards France, Manawydan gazed upon the town of London, and upon his companions, and heaved a great sigh, and much grief and heaviness came upon him. "Alas! Almighty heaven, woe is me," he exclaimed,
There is none save myself without a resting place this night.
Lord, said Pryderi, be not so sorrowful. Thy cousin is king of the island of the mighty, and though he should do thee wrong, thou hast never been a claimant of land or possessions. Thou art the third disinherited, 62a prince.
Yea, answered he, but although this man is my cousin, it grieveth me to see anyone in the place of my brother Bendigeidvran, neither can I be happy in the same dwelling with him. Wilt thou follow the counsel of another?
62b, said Pryderi. I stand in need of counsel, he answered, and what may that counsel be?
7 cantrips remain unto me, said Pryderi, wherein Rhiannon my mother dwells. I will bestow her upon thee and the 7 cantrips with her, and though thou hadst no possessions but those cantrips only, thou couldst not have 7 cantrips fairer than they.
Kikva, the daughter of Gwynglowa, is my wife, and since the inheritance of the cantrips belongs to me, do thou and Rhiannon enjoy them, and if thou ever desire any possessions thou wilt take these.
I do not, chieftain, said he. Heaven reward thee for thy friendship. I would show thee the best friendship in the world if thou wouldst let me.
I will, my friend, said he, and heaven reward thee. I will go with thee to seek Rhiannon and to look at thy possessions.
Thou wilt do well, he answered, and I believe that thou didst never hear a lady discourse better than she, and when she was in her prime none was ever fairer. Even now her aspect is not uncomely.
62c. They set forth, and, however long the journey, they came at length to Divad, and a feast was prepared for them against their coming to Narberth, which Rhiannon and Kikva had provided. Then began Manawydan and Rhiannon to sit and to talk together, and from their discourse his mind and his thoughts became warm towards her, and he thought in his heart he had never beheld any lady more fulfilled of grace and beauty than she.
Pryderi, said he, I will that it be as thou didst say.
What saying was that? Asked Rhiannon.
Lady, said Pryderi, I did offer thee as a wife to Manawydan the son of Lear.
By that will I gladly abide, said Rhiannon.
Right glad am I also, said Manawydan. May heaven reward him who hath shewn unto me friendship so perfect as this.
And before the feast was over she became his bride.
Said while, tarry ye here the rest of the feast, and I will go into England to tender my homage unto Caswallon the son of Beli.
Lord, said Rhiannon, Caswallon is in Kent, thou mayest therefore tarry at the feast, and wait until he shall be nearer.
We will wait, he answered. So they finished the feast, and they began to make the circuit of Divad and to hunt, and to take their pleasure. And as they went through the country, they had never seen lands more pleasant to live in, nor better hunting grounds, nor greater plenty of honey and fish. And such was the friendship between those four, that they would not be parted from each other by night nor by day.
And in the midst of all this he went to Caswallon at Oxford, and tendered his homage, and honorable was his reception there, and highly was he praised for offering his homage.
And after his return, Pryderi and Manawydan feasted and took their ease and pleasure. And they began a feast at Narberth, for it was the chief palace, and there originated all honor. And when they had ended the first meal that night, while those who served them eat, they arose and went forth, and proceeded all four to the gorehead of Narberth, and their retinue with them. And as they sat thus, behold a peal of thunder, and with the violence of the thunderstorm, lo there came a fall of mist, so thick that not one of them could see the other. And after the mist it became light all around. And when they looked towards the place where they were wont to see cattle, and herds, and dwellings, they saw nothing now, neither house, nor beast, nor smoke, nor fire, nor man, nor dwelling, but the houses of the court empty, and desert, and uninhabited, without either man, or beast within them. And truly all their companions were lost to them, without their knowing aught of what had befallen them, save those four only.
In the name of heaven, cried Manawydan, where are they of the court, and all my host beside these?
Let us go and see,
So they came into the hall, and there was no man, and they went on to the castle, and to the sleeping place, and they saw none, and in the mead cellar and in the kitchen there was naught but desolation. So they forefeasted, and hunted, and took their pleasure. Then they began to go through the land and all the possessions that they had, and they visited the houses and dwellings, and found nothing but wild beasts. And when they had consumed their feast and all their provisions, they fed upon the prey they killed in hunting, 65, and the honey of the wild swarms. And thus they passed the first year pleasantly, and the second, but at the last they began to be weary.
Verily, said Manawydan, we must not bide thus. Let us go into England, and seek some craft whereby we may gain our support. So they went into England, and came as far as Hereford, and they betook themselves to making saddles, and Manawydan began to make housings, and he gilded and colored them with blue enamel, in the manner that he had seen it done by Lasar Lazywood, and he made the blue enamel as it was made by the other man, and therefore is it still called Couch Lasar, blue enamel, because Lasar Lazywood had wrought it.
Picture, p65.jpg. And as long as that workmanship could be had of Manawydan, neither saddle nor housing was bought of a saddler throughout all Hereford, till at length every one of the saddlers perceived that they were losing much of their gain, and that no man bought of them, but he who could not get what he sought from Manawydan. Then they assembled together, and agreed to slay him and his companions. Now they received warning of this, and took counsel whether they should leave the city.
By heaven, said Prideri, it is not my counsel that we should quit the town, but that we should slay these birds.
Not so, said Manawydan, for if we fight with them, we shall have evil fame, and shall be put in prison. It were better for us to go to another town to maintain ourselves. So they four went to another city.
What craft shall we take? Said Prideri.
We will make shields, said Manawydan.
Do we know anything about that craft?
Said Prideri.
We will try, answered he.
There they began to make shields, and fashioned them after the shape of the good shields they had seen, and they enameled them, as they had done the saddles. And they prospered in that place, so that not a shield was asked for in the whole town, but such as was had of them. Rapid therefore was their work, and numberless were the shields they made. But at last they were marked by the craftsmen, who came together in haste, and their fellow townsmen with them, and agreed that they should seek to slay them. But they received warning, and heard how the men had resolved on their destruction.
Prideri, said Manawydan, these men desire to slay us. Let us not endure this from these birds, but let us rather fall upon them and slay them.
Not so, he answered, Kajwalan and his men will hear of it, and we shall be undone.
Let us go to another town. So to another town they went.
What craft shall we take? Said Manawydan.
Whatsoever thou wilt that we know, said Prideri.
Not so, he replied, but let us take to making shoes. For there is not courage among cordwainers either to fight with us or to molest us.
I know nothing thereof, said Prideri.
But I know, answered Manawydan, and I will teach thee to stitch.
We will not attempt to dress the leather, but we will buy it ready dressed and will make the shoes from it.
So he began by buying the best cordwool that could be had in the town, and none other would he buy except the leather for the soles, and he associated himself with the best goldsmith in the town, and caused him to make clasps for the shoes, and to gild the clasps, and he marked how it was done until he learned the method. And therefore was he called one of the three makers of gold shoes, and, when they could be had from him, not a shoe nor hose was bought of any of the cordwainers in the town. But when the cordwainers perceived that their gains were failing, for as Manawydan shaped the work, so Prideri stitched it, they came together and took counsel, and agreed that they would slay them.
Prideri, said Manawydan, these men are minded to slay us.
Wherefore should we bear this from the boorish thieves?
Said Prideri.
rather let us slay them all.
Not so, said Manawydan, we will not slay them, neither will we remain in England any longer. Let us set forth to Divod and go to see it. So they journeyed along until they came to Divod, and they went forward to Narberth, and there they kindled a fire and supported themselves by hunting. And thus they spent a month, and they gathered their dogs around them, and tarried there 1 year. Picture, p68.jpg. And one morning Pryderi and Manawydan rose up to hunt, and they ranged their dogs and went forth from the palace. And some of the dogs ran before them and came to a small bush which was near at hand. But as soon as they were come to the bush, they hastily drew back and returned to the men, their hair bristling up greatly. Let us go near to the bush, said Pryderi, and see what is in it. And as they came near, behold, a wild boar of a pure white color rose up from the bush. Then the dogs being set on by the men, rushed towards him, but he left the bush and fell back a little way from the men, and made a stand against the dogs without retreating from them, until the men had come near. And when the men came up, he fell back a second time, and betook him to flight. Then they pursued the boar until they beheld a vast and lofty castle, all newly built, in a place where they had never before seen either stone or building. And the boar ran swiftly into the castle and the dogs after him. Now when the boar and the dogs had gone into the castle, they began to wonder at finding a castle in a place where they had never before then seen any building whatsoever. And from the top of the gorse they looked and listened for the dogs. But so long as they were there they heard not one of the dogs nor aught concerning them. Lord, said Pryderi, I will go into the castle to get tidings of the dogs. Truly, he replied, thou wouldst be unwise to go into this castle, which thou hast never seen till now. If thou wouldst follow my counsel, thou wouldst not enter therein. Whosoever has cast a spell over this land, has caused this castle to be here. Of a truth, answered Pryderi, I cannot thus give up my dogs. And for all the counsel that Manawydan gave him, yet to the castle he went. When he came within the castle, neither man nor beast, nor boar nor dogs, nor house nor dwelling saw he within it. But in the center of the castle floor he beheld a fountain with marble work around it, and on the margin of the fountain a golden bowl upon a marble slab, and chains hanging from the air, to which he saw no end. And he was greatly pleased with the beauty of the gold, and with the rich workmanship of the bowl, and he went up to the bowl and laid hold of it. And when he had taken hold of it his hands stuck to the bowl, and his feet to the slab on which the bowl was placed, and all his joyousness forsook him, so that he could not utter a word. And thus he stood. And Manawydan waited for him till near the close of the day, and late in the evening, being certain that he should have no tidings of Pryderi or of the dogs, he went back to the palace. And as he entered, Rhiannon looked at him. Where, said she, are thy companion and thy dogs? Behold, he answered, the adventure that has befallen me. And he related it all unto her. An evil companion hast thou been, said Rhiannon, and a good companion hast thou lost. And with that word she went out, and proceeded towards the castle according to the direction which he gave her. The gate of the castle she found open. She was nothing daunted, and she went in. And as she went in, she perceived Pryderi laying hold of the bowl, and she went towards him. O my lord, said she, what dost thou here? And she took hold of the bowl with him, and as she did so, her hands also became fast to the bowl, and her feet to the slab, and she was not able to utter a word. And with that, as it became night, lo, there came thunder upon them, and a fall of mist, and thereupon the castle vanished, and they with it. When Kikva the daughter of Gwynglou saw that there was no one in the palace but herself and Manawydan, she sorrowed so that she cared not whether she lived or died. And Manawydan saw this. Thou art in the wrong,
said he, if through fear of me thou grievest thus, I call heaven to witness that thou hast never seen friendship more pure than that which I will bear thee, as long as heaven will that thou shouldst be thus. I declare to thee that were I in the dawn of youth I would keep my faith unto Pryderi, and unto thee also will I keep it. Be there no fear upon thee, therefore, said he, for heaven is my witness that thou shalt meet with all the friendship thou canst wish, and that it is in my power to show thee, as long as it shall please heaven to continue us in this grief and woe. Heaven reward thee, she said, and that is what I deemed of thee. And the damsel thereupon took courage and was glad.
Truly, lady, said Manawydan, it is not fitting for us to stay here. We have lost our dogs, and we cannot get food. Let us go into England. It is easiest for us to find support there.
Gladly, lord, said she, we will do so. And they set forth together to England.
Lord, said she, what craft wilt thou follow?
Take up one that is seemly.
None other will I take, answered he, save that of making shoes, as I did formerly.
Lord, said she, such a craft becomes not a man so nobly born as thou.
By that however will I abide, said he.
So he began his craft, and he made all his work of the finest leather he could get in the town, and, as he had done at the other place, he caused gilded clasps to be made for the shoes.
71 And except himself all the cordwainers in the town were idle, and without work. For as long as they could be had from him, neither shoes nor hose were bought elsewhere. And thus they tarried there a year, until the cordwainers became envious, and took counsel concerning him. And he had warning thereof, and it was told him how the cordwainers had agreed together to slay him.
Lord, said Kitva, wherefore should this be born from these burrs?
Nay, said he, we will go back unto Dived.
So towards Dived they set forth.
Now Manoidan, when he set out to return to Dived, took with him a burden of wheat, and he proceeded towards Narberth, and there he dwelt. And never was he better pleased than when he saw Narberth again, and the lands where he had been wont to hunt with Pryderi and with Rhiannon. And he accustomed himself to fish, and to hunt the deer in their covert. And then he began to prepare some ground, and he sowed a croft, and a second, and a third. And no wheat in the world ever sprung up better. And the three crofts prospered with perfect growth, and no man ever saw fair wheat than it. And thus passed the seasons of the year until the harvest came. And he went to look at one of his crofts, and behold it was ripe.
I will reap this tomorrow, said he.
And that night he went back to Narberth, and on the morrow in the grey dawn he went to root the croft, and when he came there he found nothing but the bare straw. Every one of the ears of the wheat was cut from off the stalk, and all the ears carried entirely away, and nothing but the straw left. And at this he marveled greatly. Then he went to look at another croft, and behold that also was ripe.
Verily, said he, this will I reap tomorrow.
And on the morrow he came with the intent to reap it, and when he came there he found nothing but the bare straw.
O gracious heaven, he exclaimed, I know that whosoever has begun my ruin is completing it, and has also destroyed the country with me.
Then he went to look at the third croft, and when he came there, finer wheat had there never been seen, and this also was ripe.
Evil betide me, said he, if I watch not here tonight. Whoever carried off the other corn will come in like manner to take this, and I will know who it is.
So he took his arms, and began to watch the croft, and he told Kikva all that had befallen.
Verily, said she, what thinkest thou to do?
I will watch the croft tonight, said he.
And he went to watch the croft.
And at midnight, lo, there arose the loudest tumult in the world. And he looked, and behold the mightiest host of mice in the world, which could neither be numbered nor measured. And he knew not what it was until the mice had made their way into the croft, and each of them climbing up the straw and bending it down with its weight, and had cut off one of the ears of wheat, and had carried it away, leaving there the stalk,
and he saw not a single straw there that had not a mouse to it, and they all took their way, carrying the ears with them. In wrath and anger did he rush upon the mice, but he could no more come up with them than if they had been gnats, or birds in the air, except one only, which though it was but sluggish, went so fast that a man on foot could scarce overtake it. 73 And after this one he went, and he caught it and put it in his glove, and tied up the opening of the glove with a string, and kept it with him, and returned to the palace. Then he came to the hall where Kitva was, and he lighted a fire, and hung the glove by the string upon a peg. "What hast thou there, lord?" said Kitva. "A thief," said he, "that I found robbing me." "What kind of thief may it be, lord, that thou couldst put into thy glove?" said she. "Behold, I will tell thee," he answered. Then he showed her how his fields had been wasted and destroyed, and how the mice came to the last of the fields in his sight. "And one of them was less nimble than the rest, and is now in my glove. Tomorrow I will hang it, and before heaven, if I had them, I would hang them all." "My lord," said she, "this is marvelous, but yet it would be unseemly for a man of dignity like thee to be hanging such a reptile as this. And if thou do aright, thou wilt not meddle with the creature, but wilt let it go." "Woe betide me," said he, "if I would not hang them all could I catch them, and such as I have I will hang." "Verily, lord," said she, "there is no reason that I should succor this reptile, except to prevent discredit unto thee. Do therefore, lord, as thou wilt. If I knew of any cause in the world wherefore thou shouldst succor it, I would take thy counsel concerning it," said Manawydan, "but as I know of none, lady, I am minded to destroy it." "Do so willingly then," said she. And then he went to the gorset of Narberth, taking the mouse with him. And he set up two forks on the highest part of the gorset. And while he was doing this, behold, he saw a scholar coming towards him, in old and poor and tattered garments. And it was now 7 years since he had seen in that place either man or beast, except those four persons who had remained together until two of them were lost. "My lord," said the scholar, "good day to thee. Heaven prosper thee, and my greeting be unto thee." "And whence dost thou come, scholar?" asked he. "I come, lord, from singing in England." "And wherefore dost thou inquire?" "Because for the last 7 years," answered he, "I have seen no man here save four secluded persons, and thyself this moment." "Truly, lord," said he, "I go through this land unto mine own." "And what work art thou upon, lord?" "I am hanging a thief that I caught robbing me," said he. "What manner of thief is that?" asked the scholar. "I see a creature in thy hand like unto a mouse, and ill does it become a man of rank equal to thine, to touch a reptile such as this. Let it go forth free." "I will not let it go free, by heaven," said he. "I caught it robbing me, and the doom of a thief will I inflict upon it, and I will hang it." "Lord," said he, "rather than see a man of rank equal to thine at such a work as this, I would give thee a pound which I have received as alms, to let the reptile go forth free." "I will not let it go free," said he, "by heaven, neither will I sell it." "As thou wilt, lord," he answered, "except that I would not see a man of rank equal to thine touching such a reptile, I care not." And the scholar went his way. And as he was placing the crossbeam upon the two forks, behold, a priest came towards him upon a horse covered with trappings. "Good day to thee, lord," said he.
"Heaven prosper thee," said Manawydan.
"Thy blessing."
"The blessing of heaven be upon thee."
"And what, lord, art thou doing?"
"I am hanging a thief that I caught robbing me," said he.
"What manner of thief, lord?" asked he.
"A creature," he answered, "in form of a mouse. It has been robbing me, and I am inflicting upon it the doom of a thief."
"Lord," said he, "rather than see thee touch this reptile, I would purchase its freedom. By my confession to heaven, neither will I sell it nor set it free."
"It is true, lord,"
that it is worth nothing to buy, but rather than see thee defile thyself by touching such a reptile as this, I will give thee £3 to let it go. I will not, by heaven, said he, take any price for it. As it ought, so shall it be hanged. Willingly, Lord, do thy good pleasure. And the priest went his way. Then he noosed the string round the mouse's neck, and as he was about to draw it up, behold, he saw a bishop's retinue, with his sumpter horses, and his attendants, and the bishop himself came towards him. And he stayed his work. Lord Bishop, said he, thy blessing. Heaven's blessing be unto thee, said he, what work art thou upon? Hanging a thief that I caught robbing me, said he. Is not that a mouse that I see in thy hand? Yes, answered he. And she has robbed me. I, said he, since I have come at the doom of this reptile I will ransom it of thee. I will give thee £7 for it, and that rather than see a man of rank equal to thine destroying so vile a reptile as this. Let it loose and thou shalt have the money. I declare to heaven that I will not set it loose. If thou wilt not loose it for this, I will give thee £4.20 of ready money to set it free. I will not set it free, by heaven, for as much again, said he. If thou wilt not set it free for this, I will give thee all the horses that thou sayest in this plain, and the 7 loads of baggage, and the 7 horses that they are upon. By heaven, I will not, he replied, since for this thou wilt not, do so at what price soever thou wilt. I will do so, said he. I will that Rhiannon and Pryderi be free, said he. That thou shalt have, he answered, not yet will I loose the mouse, by heaven. What then wouldst thou? That the charm and the illusion be removed from the 7 cantaroves of Dived. This shalt thou have also, set therefore the mouse free. I will not set it free, by heaven, said he. I will know who the mouse may be. She is my wife. Even though she be, I will not set her free. Wherefore came she to me? To despoil thee, he answered. I am Lwyd, the son of Kilcoed, and I cast the charm over the 7 cantaroves of Dived. And it was to avenge Gwal, the son of Glud, from the friendship I had towards him, that I cast the charm. And upon Pryderi did I revenge Gwal, the son of Glud, for the game of badger in the bag, that Will Penan played upon him, which he did unadvisedly in the court of Heavy Eat Hen. And when it was known that thou wast come to dwell in the land, my household came and besought me to transform them into mice, that they might destroy thy corn. And it was my own household that went the first night, and the second night also they went, and they destroyed thy 2 crofts. And the 3rd night came unto me my wife and the ladies of the court, and besought me to transform them. And I transformed them. Now she is pregnant. And had she not been pregnant thou wouldst not have been able to overtake her, but since this has taken place and she has been caught, I will restore thee Pryderi and Rhiannon, and I will take the charm and illusion from off Dived. I have now told thee who she is. Set her therefore free. I will not set her free, by heaven, said he. What wilt thou more? He asked. I will that there be no more charm upon the 7 cantaroves of Dived, and that none shall be put upon it henceforth. This thou shalt have, said he. Now set her free. I will not by my faith, he answered. What wilt thou furthermore? Asked he. Behold, said he, this will I have, that vengeance be never taken for this, either upon Pryderi or Rhiannon, or upon me. All this shalt thou have. And truly thou hast done wisely in asking this. Upon thy head would have let all this trouble. Yea, said he, for fear thereof was it, that I required this. Set now my wife at liberty. I will not, by heaven, said he, until I see Pryderi and Rhiannon with me free. Behold, here they come, he answered. And thereupon behold Pryderi and Rhiannon. And he rose up to meet them, and greeted them, and sat down beside them. Ah, chieftain, set now my wife at liberty, said the bishop. Hast thou not received all thou didst ask?
I will release her gladly, said he. And thereupon he set her free. Then he struck her with a magic wand, and she was changed back into a young woman, the fairest ever seen. Look around upon thy land, said he, and then thou wilt see it all tilled and peopled, as it was in its best state. And he rose up and looked forth, and when he looked he saw all the lands tilled, and full of herds and dwellings. What bondage, he inquired, has there been upon Priadary and Rhiannon? Priadary has had the knockers of the gate of my palace about his neck, and Rhiannon has had the collars of the asses, after they have been carrying hay, about her neck. And such had been their bondage. And by reason of this bondage is this story called the Mabinogi of Minweirin Minord. 79. And thus ends this portion of the Mabinogi. Picture, p79.jpg. Math the son of M-A-T-H-O-N-W-Y. Picture, p80.jpg. Math the son of Mathenvi was lord over Gwynedd, and Priadary the son of Bwyl was lord over the 21 cantrevs of the south, and these were the 7 cantrevs of Dyved, and the 7 cantrevs of Morgannwg, the 4 cantrevs of Ceredigion, and the 3 of Ystradtywy. At that time, Math the son of Mathenvi could not exist unless his feet were in the lap of a maiden, except only when he was prevented by the tumult of war. Now the maiden who was with him was Gawain, the daughter of Pebin of Dalpebin, in Arvin, and she was the fairest maiden of her time who was known there. And Math dwelt always at Caer Dathil, in Arvin, and was not able to go the circuit of the land, but Gilvaethwy the son of Don, and Enaid, 81 the son of Don, his nephews, the sons of his sister, with his household, went the circuit of the land in his stead. Now the maiden was with Math continually, and Gilvaethwy the son of Don set his affections upon her, and loved her so that he knew not what he should do because of her, and therefrom behold his hue, and his aspect, and his spirits changed for love of her, so that it was not easy to know him. One day his brother Gwydion gazed steadfastly upon him. Youth, said he, what aileth thee? Why, replied he, what sayest thou to me? I see, said he, that thou hast lost thy aspect and thy hue. What, therefore, aileth thee? My lord, brother, he answered, that which aileth me, it will not profit me that I should own to any. What may it be, my soul? Said he. Thou knowest, he said, that Math the son of Mathenvi has this property, that if men whisper together, in a tone how low soever, if the wind meet it, it becomes known unto him. Yes, said Gwydion, hold now thy peace, I know thy intent, thou love a Gawain. When he found that his brother knew his intent, he gave the heaviest sigh in the world. Be silent, my soul, and sigh not, he said, it is not thereby that thou wilt succeed. I will cause, said he, if it cannot be otherwise, the rising of Gwynedd, and Powys, and Deubart, to seek the maiden. Be thou of glad cheer therefore, and I will compass it. So they went unto Math the son of Mathenvi. Lord, said Gwydion, I have heard that there have come to the south some beasts, such as were never known in this island before. What are they called? He asked. Pigs, Lord. And what kind of animals are they? They are small animals, and their flesh is better than the flesh of oxen. They are small then? And they change their names. Swine are they now called. Who owneth them? Priadary the son of Bwyl. They were sent him from An, by Aeron the king of An, and still they keep that name, half hog, half pig. Verily, asked he, and by what means may they be obtained from him? I will go, Lord, as one of 12 in the guise of Bardas, to seek the swine. But it may be that he will refuse you, said he. My journey will not be evil, Lord, said he, I will not come back without the swine. Gladly, said he, go thou forward. So he and Gilvaethwy went, and 10 other men with them, and they came into Ceredigion,
to the place that is now called Rutlantivy, where the palace of Pryderi was. In the guise of bards they came in, and they were received joyfully, and Gwydion was placed beside Pryderi that night. "Of a truth," said Pryderi, "gladly would I have a tale from some of your men yonder."
"Lord," said Gwydion, "we have a custom that the first night that we come to the court of a great man, the chief of song recites.
Gladly will I relate a tale." Now Gwydion was the best teller of tales in the world, and he diverted all the court that night with pleasant discourse and with tales, so that he charmed everyone in the court, and it pleased Pryderi to talk with him.
"And after this, Lord," said he unto Pryderi, "were it more pleasing to thee, that another should discharge my errand unto thee, than that I should tell thee myself what it is?"
"No," he answered, "ample speech hast thou."
"Behold, then, Lord," said he, "my errand. It is to crave from thee the animals that were sent thee from hen."
"Verily," he replied, "that were the easiest thing in the world to grant, were there not a covenant between me and my land concerning them. And the covenant is that they shall not go from me, until they have produced double their number in the land."
"Lord," said he, "I can set thee free from these words, and this is the way I can do so. Give me not this wine tonight, neither refuse them unto me, and tomorrow I will show thee in exchange for them." And that night he and his fellows went unto their lodging, and they took counsel.
"Ah, my men," said he, "we shall not have this wine for the asking."
"Well," said they, "how may they be obtained?"
"I will cause them to be obtained," said Gwydion. Then he betook himself to his arts, and began to work a charm. And he caused 12 chargers to appear, and 12 black greyhounds, each of them white-breasted, and having upon them 12 collars and 12 leashes, such as no one that saw them could know to be other than gold, and upon the horses 12 saddles, and every part which should have been of iron was entirely of gold, and the bridles were of the same workmanship. And with the horses and the dogs he came to Pryderi.
Picture, p84.jpg. "Good day unto thee, Lord," said he.
"Heaven prosper thee," said the other, "and greetings be unto thee."
"Lord," said he, "behold, here is a release for thee from the word which thou spake last evening concerning this wine, that thou wilt neither give nor sell them. Thou mayest exchange them for that which is better. And I will give these 12 horses, all caparisoned as they are, with their saddles and their bridles, and these 12 greyhounds, with their collars and their leashes as thou sayest, and the 12 gilded shields that thou beholdest yonder." Now these he had formed of fungus. "Well," said he, "we will take counsel." And they consulted together, and determined to give this wine to Gwydion, and to take his horses and his dogs and his shields.
Then Gwydion and his men took their leave, and began to journey forth with the pigs.
"Ah, my comrades," said Gwydion, "it is needful that we journey with speed. The illusion will not last but from the one hour to the same tomorrow."
And that night they journeyed as far as the upper part of Seredigion, to the place which, from that cause, is called Mokdrev still. And the next day they took their course through Melanid, and came that night to the town which is likewise for that reason called Mokdrev, between Kerry and Erwisley. And thence they journeyed forward. And that night they came as far as that comet in Powys, which also upon account thereof is called Mognant, and there tarried they that night. And they journeyed thence to the Cantrev of Rose, and the place where they were that night is still called Mokdrev.
"My men," said Gwydion, "we must push forward to the fastnesses of Gwynedd with these animals, for there is a gathering of hosts in pursuit of us." So they journeyed on to the highest town of Arlegwed, and there they made a sty for this wine, and therefore was the name of Cruoirion given to that town. And after they had made the sty for this wine, they proceeded to Math the son of Mathenvi, at Cairdathil. And when they came there, the country was rising.
"What news is there here?"
asked Gwydion.
"Pryderi is assembling 1 in 20 cantrevs to pursue after you," answered they.
It is marvelous that you should have journeyed so slowly. Where are the animals whereof you went in quest? Said Math. They have had a sty made for them in the other kentrov below, said Gwydion. Thereupon, lo, they heard the trumpets and the host in the land, and they arrayed themselves and set forward and came to Penard in Arvon. And at night Gwydion the son of Don, and Gilvaithwy his brother, returned to Cerdithil, and Gilvaithwy took Math the son of Maithanwy's couch, and while he turned out the other damsels from the room discourteously, he made Gawain unwillingly remain. And when they saw the day on the morrow, they went back unto the place where Math the son of Mathenvy was with his host, and when they came there, the warriors were taking counsel in what district they should await the coming of Pryderi, and the men of the south. So they went into the council, and it was resolved to wait in the strongholds of Gwynedd, in Arvon. So within the two manors they took their stand, Mienor Penard and Mienor Coed Allen, and there Pryderi attacked them, and there the combat took place, and great was the slaughter on both sides, but the men of the south were forced to flee, and they fled unto the place which is still called Nancall, and thither did they follow them, and they made a vast slaughter of them there, so that they fled again as far as the place called Del Penmen, and there they halted and sought to make peace. And that he might have peace, Pryderi gave hostages, Grugi Gwaestor gave he and 23 others, sons of nobles, and after this they journeyed in peace even unto Traethmore, but as they went on together towards Melinride, the men on foot could not be restrained from shooting. Pryderi dispatched unto Math an embassy to pray him to forbid his people, and to leave it between him and Gwydion the son of Don, for that he had caused all this. And the messengers came to Math. Of a truth, said Math, I call heaven to witness, if it be pleasing unto Gwydion the son of Don, I will so leave it gladly. Never will I compel any to go to fight, but that we ourselves should do our utmost. Verily, said the messengers, Pryderi saith that it were more fair that the man who did him this wrong should oppose his own body to his, and let his people remain unscathed. I declare to heaven, I will not ask the men of Gwynedd to fight because of me. If I am allowed to fight Pryderi myself, gladly will I oppose my body to his. And this answer they took back to Pryderi. Truly, said Pryderi, I shall require no one to demand my rights but myself. Then these two came forth and armed themselves, and they fought, and by force of strength, and fierceness, and by the magic and charms of Gwydion, Pryderi was slain, and at Main Tyrioch, 87 above Melinrid, was he buried, and there is his grave. And the men of the south set forth in sorrow towards their own land, nor is it a marvel that they should grieve, seeing that they had lost their lord, and many of their best warriors, and for the most part, their horses and their arms. The men of Gwynedd went back joyful and in triumph. Lord, said Gwydion unto Math, would it not be right for us to release the hostages of the men of the south, which they pledged unto us for peace? For we ought not to put them in prison. Let them then be set free, said Math, so that youth, and the other hostages that were with him, were set free to follow the men of the south. Math himself went forward to Cerdithil. Gilvuthwy the son of Don, and they have the household that were with him went to make the circuit of Gwynedd as they were wont, without coming to the court. Math went into his chamber, and caused a place to be prepared for him whereon to recline, so that he might put his feet in the maiden's lap. Lord, said Gawain, seek now another, 88, to hold thy feet, for I am now a wife. What meaneth this? Said he. An attack, Lord, was made unawares upon me, but I held not my peace, and there was no one in the court who knew not of it. Now the attack was made by thy nephews, Lord, the sons of thy sister, Gwydion the son of Don, and Gilvaithwy the son of Don, unto me they did wrong, and unto thee dishonor. Verily, he exclaimed, I will do to the utmost of my power concerning this matter,
But first I will cause thee to have compensation, and then will I have amends made unto myself. As for thee, I will take thee to be my wife, and the possession of my dominions will I give unto thy hands. And Gwydion and Gilvathwy came not near the court, but stayed in the confines of the land until it was forbidden to give them meat and drink. At first they come not near unto Math, but at last they came. Lord, said they, good day to thee. Well, said he, is it to make me compensation that ye are come? Lord, they said, we are at thy will. By my will I would not have lost my warriors, and so many arms as I have done. You cannot compensate me my shame, setting aside the death of Pryderi. But since ye come hither to be at my will, I shall begin your punishment forthwith. Then he took his magic wand, and struck Gilvathwy, so that he became a deer, and he seized upon the other hastily lest it should escape from him. And he struck him with the same magic wand, and he became a deer also. Since now ye are in bonds, I will that ye go forth together and be companions, and possess the nature of the animals whose form ye bear. And this day 12 months come hither unto me. At the end of a year from that day, lo, there was a loud noise under the chamber wall, and the barking of the dogs of the palace together with the noise. Look, said he, what is without? Lord, said one, I have looked, there are there 2 deer, and a fawn with them. Then he arose and went out, and when he came he beheld the 3 animals. And he lifted up his wand. As ye were deer last year, be wild hogs each and either of you, for the year that is to come. And thereupon he struck them with the magic wand. The young one will I take and cause to be baptized. Now the name that he gave him was Hyden. Go ye and be wild swine, each and either of you, and be of the nature of wild swine. And this day 12 months be here under the wall. At the end of the year the barking of dogs was heard under the wall of the chamber. And the court assembled, and thereupon he arose and went forth, and when he came forth he beheld 3 beasts. Now these were the beasts that he saw, 2 wild hogs of the woods, and a well-grown young one with them. And he was very large for his age. Truly, said Math, this one will I take and cause to be baptized. And he struck him with his magic wand, and he became a fine fair auburn-haired youth, and the name that he gave him was Hyten. Now as for you, as ye were wild hogs last year, be wolves each and either of you for the year that is to come. Thereupon he struck them with his magic wand, and they became wolves, and be of like nature with the animals whose semblance ye bear, and return here this day 12 months beneath this wall. And the same day at the end of the year, he heard a clamor and a barking of dogs under the wall of the chamber. And he rose and went forth. And when he came, behold, he saw 2 wolves, and a strong cub with them. This one will I take, said Math, and I will cause him to be baptized. There is a name prepared for him, and that is Bleidon. Now these 3, such are they. The 3 sons of Gilvathwy the False, the 3 faithful combatants, Bleidon, Hydon, and Hydon the Tall. Then he struck the 2 with his magic wand, and they resumed their own nature. O men, said he, for the wrong that ye did unto me, sufficient has been your punishment and your dishonor. Prepare now precious ointment for these men, and wash their heads, and equip them. And this was done. And after they were equipped, they came unto him. O men, said he, you have obtained peace, and you shall likewise have friendship. Give your counsel unto me, what maiden I shall seek. Lord, said Gwydion the son of Don, it is easy to give thee counsel. Seek Arianrod, 91a, the daughter of Don, thy niece, thy sister's daughter. And they brought her unto him, and the maiden came in. Ha, damsel, said he, art thou the maiden? I know not, Lord, other than that I am. Then he took up his magic wand, and bent it. Step over this, said he, and I shall know if thou art the maiden. Then stepped she over the magic wand, and there appeared forthwith a fine chubby yellow-haired boy.
and at the crying out of the boy, she went towards the door, and thereupon some small form was seen, but before anyone could get a second glimpse of it, Gwydion had taken it, and had flung a scarf of velvet around it and hidden it. Now the place where he hid it was the bottom of a chest at the foot of his bed. "Verily," said Math the son of Mathenvi, "concerning the fine yellow-haired boy, I will cause this one to be baptized, and Dylan is the name I will give him." So they had the boy baptized, and as they baptized him he plunged into the sea, and immediately when he was in the sea, he took its nature, and swam as well as the best fish that was therein, and for that reason was he called Dylan, the son of the wave. Beneath him no wave ever broke, and the blow whereby he came to his death was struck by his uncle Gulvanion. The third fatal, 91b, blow was it called. As Gwydion lay one morning on his bed awake, he heard a cry in the chest at his feet, and though it was not loud, it was such that he could hear it. Then he arose in haste, and opened the chest, and when he opened it, he beheld an infant boy stretching out his arms from the folds of the scarf, and casting it aside. And he took up the boy in his arms, and carried him to a place where he knew there was a woman that could nurse him. And he agreed with the woman that she should take charge of the boy. And that year he was nursed. And at the end of the year, he seemed by his size as though he were 2 years old. And the second year he was a big child, and able to go to the court by himself. And when he came to the court, Gwydion noticed him, and the boy became familiar with him, and loved him better than anyone else. Then was the boy reared at the court until he was 4 years old, when he was as big as though he had been 8. And one day Gwydion walked forth, and the boy followed him, and he went to the castle of Arianrod, having the boy with him. And when he came into the court, Arianrod arose to meet him, and greeted him and bade him welcome. "Heaven prosper thee," said he. "Who is the boy that followeth thee?" She asked. "This youth, he is thy son," he answered. "Alas," said she, "what has come unto thee that thou shouldst shame me thus? Wherefore dost thou seek my dishonor, and retain it so long as this? Unless thou suffer dishonor greater than that of my bringing up such a boy as this, small will be thy disgrace." "What is the name of the boy?" said she. "Verily," he replied, "he has not yet a name." "Well," she said, "I lay this destiny upon him, that he shall never have a name until he receives one from me." "Heaven bears me witness," answered he, "that thou art a wicked woman. But the boy shall have a name, how displeasing soever it may be unto thee. As for thee, that which afflicts thee is that thou art no longer called a damsel." And thereupon he went forth in wrath, and returned to Caerdathil, and there he tarried that night. And the next day he arose and took the boy with him, and went to walk on the seashore between that place and Abermini. And there he saw some sedges and seaweed, and he turned them into a boat. And out of dry sticks, 93, and sedges he made some cord of leather, and a great deal thereof, and he colored it in such a manner that no one ever saw leather more beautiful than it. Then he made a sail to the boat, and he and the boy went in it to the port of the castle of Arianrod. And he began forming shoes and stitching them, until he was observed from the castle. And when he knew that they of the castle were observing him, he disguised his aspect, and put another semblance upon himself, and upon the boy, so that they might not be known. "What men are those in yonder boat?" said Arianrod. "They are cordwainers," answered they. "Go and see what kind of leather they have, and what kind of work they can do." So they came unto them, and when they came he was coloring some cord of leather, and gilding it. And the messengers came and told her this. "Well," said she, "take the measure of my foot, and desire the cordwainer to make shoes for me." So he made the shoes for her, yet not according to the measure, but larger. The shoes then were brought unto her, and behold they were too large. "These are too large," said she, "but he shall receive their value. Let him also make some that are smaller than they."
Then he made her others that were much smaller than her foot, and sent them unto her. "Tell him that these will not go on my feet," said she. And they told him this. "Verily," said he, "I will not make her any shoes, unless I see her foot." And this was told unto her. "Truly," she answered, "I will go unto him." So she went down to the boat, and when she came there, he was shaping shoes and the boy stitching them. "Ah, lady," said he, "good day to thee." "Heaven prosper thee," said she. "I marvel that thou canst not manage to make shoes according to a measure."
"I could not," he replied, "but now I shall be able."
Thereupon behold, a wren stood upon the deck of the boat, and the boy shot at it, and hit it in the leg between the sinew and the bone. Then she smiled. "Verily," said she, "with a steady hand did the lion aim at it. Heaven reward thee not, but now has he got a name, and a good enough name it is. Lulajifs be he called henceforth." Then the work disappeared in seaweed and sedges, and he went on with it no further, and for that reason was he called the third gold shoemaker. "Of a truth," said she, "thou wilt not thrive the better for doing evil unto me." "I have done thee no evil yet," said he. Then he restored the boy to his own form. "Well," said she, "I will lay a destiny upon this boy, that he shall never have arms and armor until I invest him with them." "By heaven," said he, "let thy malice be what it may, he shall have arms." Then they went towards Dynasdinlav, and there he brought up Lulajifs, until he could manage any horse, and he was perfect in features, and strength, and stature. And then Gwydion saw that he languished through the want of horses, and arms. And he called him unto him. "Ah, youth," said he, "we will go tomorrow on an errand together. Be therefore more cheerful than thou art." "That I will," said the youth. Next morning, at the dawn of day, they arose, and they took their way along the sea coast, up towards Brynarion, and at the top of Seven Clitno they equipped themselves with horses, and went towards the castle of Arianrod, and they changed their form, and pricked towards the gate in the semblance of two youths, but the aspect of Gwydion was more staid than that of the other. "Porter," said he, "go thou in and say that there are here bards from Glamorgan." And the porter went in. "The welcome of heaven be unto them, let them in," said Arianrod. With great joy were they greeted, and the hall was arranged, and they went to meat. When meat was ended, Arianrod discoursed with Gwydion of tales and stories. Now Gwydion was an excellent teller of tales, and when it was time to leave off feasting, a chamber was prepared for them, and they went to rest. In the early twilight Gwydion arose, and he called unto him his magic and his power. And by the time that the day dawned, there resounded through the land uproar, and trumpets, and shouts. When it was now day, they heard a knocking at the door of the chamber, and therewith Arianrod asking that it might be opened. Up rose the youth and opened unto her, and she entered and a maiden with her. "Ah, good man," she said, "in evil plight are we." "Yes, truly," said Gwydion, "we have heard trumpets, and shouts. What thinkest thou that they may mean?" "Verily," said she, "we cannot see the color of the ocean by reason of all the ships, side by side, and they are making for the land with all the speed they can." "And what can we do?" said she. "Lady," said Gwydion, "there is none other counsel than to close the castle upon us, and to defend it as best we may." "Truly," said she, "may heaven reward you. And do you defend it, and here you may have plenty of arms." And thereupon went she forth for the arms, and behold she returned, and two maidens, and suits of armor for two men, with her. "Lady," said he, "do thou accouter this stripling, and I will arm myself with the help of thy maidens. Lo, I hear the tumult of the men approaching." "I will do so, gladly." So she armed him fully, and that right cheerfully. "Hast thou finished arming the youth?" said he. "I have finished," she answered. "I likewise have finished," said Gwydion.
Let us now take off our arms, we have no need of them.
Wherefore?
Said she. Here is the army around the house.
Oh, lady, there is here no army.
Oh, cried she, whence then was this tumult?
The tumult was but to break thy prophecy, 96, and to obtain arms for thy son. And now has he got arms without any thanks unto thee.
By heaven, said Arianrod, thou art a wicked man. Many a youth might have lost his life, through the uproar thou hast caused in this cantre of today. Now will I lay a destiny upon this youth, she said, that he shall never have a wife of the race that now inhabits this earth.
Verily, said he, thou wast ever a malicious woman, and no one ought to support thee.
A wife shall he have notwithstanding.
Picture, p97.jpg. They went thereupon unto Math, the son of Mathenvi, and complained unto him most bitterly of Arianrod.
Gwydion showed him also how he had procured arms for the youth.
Well, said Math, we will seek, I and thou, by charms and illusion, to form a wife for him out of flowers. He has now come to man's stature, and he is the comeliest youth that was ever beheld. So they took the blossoms of the oak, and the blossoms of the broom, and the blossoms of the meadow sweet, and produced from them a maiden, the fairest and most graceful that man ever saw. And they baptized her, 98a, and gave her the name of Blow-to-Wed. After she had become his bride, and they had feasted, said Gwydion, it is not easy for a man to maintain himself without possessions.
Of a truth, said Math, I will give the young man the best kentrov to hold.
98b, lord, said he, what kentrov is that?
The kentrov of Dinodig, he answered. Now it is called at this day Ivanid and Ardodwi. And the place in the kentrov where he dwelt was a palace of his in a spot called Murray Castell, on the confines of Ardodwi. There dwelt he and reigned, and both he and his sway were beloved by all.
One day he went forth to Caerdathil, to visit Math, the son of Mathenvi. And on the day that he set out for Caerdathil, Blow-to-Wed walked in the court. And she heard the sound of a horn. And after the sound of the horn, behold, a tired stag went by, with dogs and huntsmen following it. And after the dogs and the huntsmen there came a crowd of men on foot.
Send a youth, said she, to ask who yonder host may be.
So a youth went, and inquired who they were.
Grown with peber is this, the lord of Penlyn, said they.
And thus the youth told her.
Grown with peber pursued the stag, and by the river Sinvale he overtook the stag and killed it.
And what? With flaying the stag and baiting his dogs, he was there until the night began to close in upon him. And as the day departed and the night drew near, he came to the gate of the court.
Verily, said Blow-to-Wed, the chieftain will speak ill of us, if we let him at this hour depart to another land without inviting him in.
Yes, truly, lady, said they, it will be most fitting to invite him.
Then went messengers to meet him and bid him in. And he accepted her bidding gladly, and came to the court, and Blow-to-Wed went to meet him and greeted him, and bade him welcome.
Lady, said he, heaven repay thee thy kindness.
When they had disaccoutred themselves, they went to sit down, and Blow-to-Wed looked upon him, and from the moment that she looked on him she became filled with his love. And he gazed on her, and the same thought came unto him as unto her, so that he could not conceal from her that he loved her, but he declared unto her that he did so.
Thereupon she was very joyful, and all their discourse that night was concerning the affection and love which they felt one for the other, and which in no longer space than one evening had arisen, and that evening passed they in each other's company.
The next day he sought to depart, but she said, I pray thee go not from me today.
And that night he tarried also, and that night they consulted by what means they might always be together.
There is none other counsel, said he, but that thou strive to learn from Lulogifs in what manner he will meet his death. And this must thou do under the semblance of solicitude concerning him.
The next day Grown was sought to depart.
Verily, said she, I would counsel thee not to go from me today. At thy instance, will I not go, said he, albeit, I must say, there is danger, that the chief who owns the palace may return home. Tomorrow, answered she, will I indeed permit thee to go forth. The next day he sought to go, and she hindered him not. Be mindful, said Gronwa, of what I have said unto thee, and converse with him fully, and that under the guise of the dalliance of love, and find out by what means he may come to his death. That night Lulodgifs returned to his home, and the day they spent in discourse, and minstrelsy, and feasting, and at night they went to rest, and he spoke to Bloduwed once, and he spoke to her a second time. But, for all this, he could not get from her one word. What aileth thee, said he, art thou well? I was thinking, said she, of that which thou didst never think of concerning me, for I was sorrowful as to thy death, lest thou should go sooner than I. Heaven reward thy care for me, said he, but until heaven take me I shall not easily be slain. For the sake of heaven, and for mine, show me how thou mightest be slain. My memory in guarding is better than thine. I will tell thee gladly, said he. Not easily can I be slain, except by a wound. 100 and the spear wherewith I am struck must be a year in the forming, and nothing must be done towards it except during the sacrifice on Sundays. Is this certain? Asked she. It is in truth, he answered, and I cannot be slain within a house, nor without. I cannot be slain on horseback nor on foot. Verily, said she, in what manner then canst thou be slain? I will tell thee, said he, by making a bath for me by the side of a river, and by putting a roof over the cauldron, and thatching it well and tightly, and bringing a buck, and putting it beside the cauldron. Then if I place one foot on the buck's back, and the other on the edge of the cauldron, whosoever strikes me thus will cause my death. Well, said she, I thank heaven that it will be easy to avoid this. No sooner had she held this discourse than she sent to Gronwa Peber. Gronwa toiled at making the spear, and that day 12 months it was ready, and that very day he caused her to be informed thereof. Lord, said Bloduwed unto Lu, I have been thinking how it is possible that what thou didst tell me formerly can be true. Wilt thou show me in what manner thou couldst stand at once upon the edge of a cauldron and upon a buck, if I prepare the bath for thee? I will show thee, said he. Then she sent unto Gronwa, and bade him be in ambush on the hill which is now called Brincovergir, on the bank of the river Sinveale. She caused also to be collected all the goats that were in the Cantref, and had them brought to the other side of the river, opposite Brincovergir. And the next day she spoke thus. Lord, said she, I have caused the roof and the bath to be prepared, and lo, they are ready. Well, said Lu, we will go gladly to look at them. The day after they came and looked at the bath. Wilt thou go into the bath, Lord? Said she. Willingly will I go in, he answered. So into the bath he went, and he anointed himself. Lord, said she, behold the animals which thou didst speak of as being called bucks. Well, said he, cause one of them to be caught and brought here. And the buck was brought. Then Lu rose out of the bath, and put on his trousers, and he placed one foot on the edge of the bath and the other on the buck's back. Thereupon Gronwa rose up from the hill which is called Brincovergir, and he rested on one knee, and flung the poison dart and struck him on the side, so that the shaft started out, but the head of the dart remained in. Then he flew up in the form of an eagle, and gave a fearful scream, and thenceforth was he no more seen. As soon as he departed Gronwa and Bloduwed went together unto the palace that night, and the next day Gronwa arose and took possession of Ardudwy, and after he had overcome the land, he ruled over it, so that Ardudwy and Penland were both under his sway. Then these tidings reached Math the son of Mathenvi, and heaviness and grief came upon Math,
and much more upon Gwydion than upon him.
Lord, said Gwydion, I shall never rest until I have tidings of my nephew.
Verily, said Math, may heaven be thy strength.
Then Gwydion set forth and began to go forward, and he went through Gwynedd and Powys to the confines.
And when he had done so, he went into Arvin, and came to the house of a vassal, in Maynard Penard.
And he alighted at the house, and stayed there that night.
The man of the house and his household came in, and last of all came there the swineherd.
Said the man of the house to the swineherd,
Well, youth, hath thy sow come in tonight?
She hath, said he, and is this instant returned to the pigs.
Where doth this sow go to?
Said Gwydion.
Every day, when the sty is opened, she goeth forth and none can catch sight of her, neither is it known whither she goeth more than if she sank into the earth.
Wilt thou grant unto me, said Gwydion, not to open the sty until I am beside the sty with thee?
This will I do, right gladly, he answered.
That night they went to rest, and as soon as the swineherd saw the light of day, he awoke Gwydion.
And Gwydion arose and dressed himself, and went with the swineherd, and stood aside the sty.
Then the swineherd opened the sty, and as soon as he opened it, behold, she leaped forth, and set off with great speed.
And Gwydion followed her, and she went against the course of a river, and made for a brook, which is now called Nant Elu.
And there she halted and began feeding.
And Gwydion came under the tree, and looked what it might be that the sow was feeding on.
And he saw that she was eating putrid flesh and vermin.
Then looked he up to the top of the tree, and as he looked he beheld on the top of the tree an eagle, and when the eagle shook itself, there fell vermin and putrid flesh from off it, and these the sow devoured.
And it seemed to him that the eagle was Lu.
And he sang an anglin.
Oak that grows between the two banks, darkened is the sky and hill. Shall I not tell him by his wounds, that this is Lu?
Upon this the eagle came down until he reached the center of the tree.
And Gwydion sang another anglin.
Oak that grows in upland ground, is it not wetted by the rain? Has it not been drenched by 90 tempests? It bears in its branches Lu logifs.
Then the eagle came down until he was on the lowest branch of the tree, and thereupon this anglin did Gwydion sing.
Oak that grows beneath the steep, stately and majestic is its aspect. Shall I not speak it, that Lu will come to my lap?
And the eagle came down upon Gwydion's knee, and Gwydion struck him with his magic wand, so that he returned to his own form.
No one ever saw a more piteous sight, for he was nothing but skin and bone.
Then he went unto Cairdathil, and there were brought unto him good physicians that were in Gwynedd, and before the end of the year he was quite healed.
Lord, said he unto Math the son of Mathenvi, it is full time now that I have retribution of him by whom I have suffered all this woe.
Truly, said Math, he will never be able to maintain himself in the possession of that which is thy right.
Well, said Lu, the sooner I have my right, the better shall I be pleased.
Then they called together the whole of Gwynedd, and set forth to Ardudwy.
And Gwydion went on before and proceeded to Murray Castell.
And when Blodiwed heard that he was coming, she took her maidens with her, and fled to the mountain.
And they passed through the river Sinveale, and went towards a court that there was upon the mountain, and through fear they could not proceed except with their faces looking backwards, so that unawares they fell into the lake.
And they were all drowned except Blodiwed herself, and her Gwydion overtook.
And he said unto her, I will not slay thee, but I will do unto thee worse than that.
For I will turn thee into a bird, and because of the shame thou hast done unto Lu logifs, thou shalt never show thy face in the light of day henceforth, and that through fear of all the other birds.
For it shall be their nature to attack thee, and to chase thee from wheresoever they may find thee.
And thou shalt not lose thy name, but shalt be always called Blodiwed.
Now Blodiwed is an owl in the language of this present time, and for this reason is the owl hateful unto all birds.
And even now the owl is called Blodiwed.
Then Gronwy Pibr withdrew unto Penlyn, and he dispatched thence an embassy. And the messengers he sent asked Lulogifs if he would take land, or domain, or gold, or silver, for the injury he had received. "I will not, by my confession to heaven," said he. "Behold, this is the least that I will accept from him, that he come to the spot where I was when he wounded me with the dart, and that I stand where he did, and that with a dart I take my aim at him. And this is the very least that I will accept." And this was told unto Gronwy Pibr. "Verily," said he, "is it needful for me to do thus? My faithful warriors, and my household, and my foster brothers, is there not one among you who will stand the blow in my stead?" "There is not, verily," answered they. "And because of their refusal to suffer one stroke for their lord, they are called the third disloyal tribe even unto this day." "Well," said he, "I will meet it." Picture, p106.jpg. Then they too went forth to the banks of the river Sinveale, and Gronwy stood in the place where Lulogifs was when he struck him, and Lu in the place where Gronwy was. Then said Gronwy Pibr unto Lu, "Since it was through the wiles of a woman that I did unto thee as I have done, I adjure thee by heaven to let me place between me and the blow this lab thou sayest yonder on the river's bank." "Verily," said Lu, "I will not refuse thee this." "Ah," said he, "may heaven reward thee." So Gronwy took this lab and placed it between him and the blow. Then Lu flung the dart at him, and it pierced the slab and went through Gronwy likewise, so that it pierced through his back. And thus was Gronwy Pibr slain. And there is still the slab on the bank of the river Sinveale, in Ardudwy, having the hole through it. And therefore it is even now called Lech Gronwy. A second time did Lulogifs take possession of the land, and prosperously did he govern it. And as the story relates, he was lord after this over Gwynedd, and thus ends this portion of the Mabinogi. Here is the story of Lludd and Llevelys. Picture, p108.jpg. Billy the Great, son of Manogan, had three sons, Lud, and Cajwalon, and Ninya, and according to the story he had a fourth son called Llevelys. And after the death of Billy, the kingdom of the island of Britain fell into the hands of Lud, his eldest son, and Lud ruled prosperously, and rebuilt the walls of London, and encompassed it about with numberless towers. And after that he bade the citizens build houses therein, such as no houses in the kingdom could equal. And moreover he was a mighty warrior, and generous and liberal in giving meat and drink to all that sought them. And though he had many castles and cities, this one loved he more than any. And he dwelt therein most part of the year, and therefore was it called Caer Lud, and at last Caer London. And after the stranger race came there, it was called London, or Londres. Lud loved Llevelys best of all his brothers, because he was a wise and a discreet man. Having heard that the king of France had died, leaving no heir, except a daughter, and that he had left all his possessions in her hands, he came to Lud his brother, to beseech his counsel and aid, and that not so much for his own welfare, as to seek to add to the glory and honor and dignity of his kindred, if he might go to France to woo the maiden for his wife. And forthwith his brother conferred with him, and this counsel was pleasing unto him. So he prepared ships and filled them with armed knights, and set forth towards France. And as soon as they had landed, they sent messengers to show the nobles of France the cause of the embassy. And by the joint counsel of the nobles of France and of the princes, the maiden was given to Llevelys, and the crown of the kingdom with her. And thenceforth he ruled the land discreetly, and wisely, and happily, as long as his life lasted. After a space of time had passed, three plagues fell on the island of Britain, such as none in the islands had ever seen the like. The first was a certain race that came, and was called the Curanians, and so great was their knowledge, that there was no discourse upon the face of the island, however low it might be spoken, but what, if the wind met it, it was known to them.
and through this they could not be injured. The second plague was a shriek which came on every May Eve, over every hearth in the island of Britain, and this went through people's hearts, and so scared them, that the men lost their hue and their strength, and the women their children, and the young men, and the maidens lost their senses, and all the animals and trees and the earth and the waters were left barren. The third plague was, that however much of provisions and food might be prepared in the king's courts, were there even so much as a year's provision of meat and drink, none of it could ever be found, except what was consumed in the first night. And two of these plagues, no one ever knew their cause, therefore was there better hope of being freed from the first than from the second and third. And thereupon King Lud felt great sorrow and care, because that he knew not how he might be freed from these plagues. And he called to him all the nobles of his kingdom, and asked counsel of them what they should do against these afflictions. And by the common counsel of the nobles, Lud the son of Belli, went to Lovelies his brother, king of France, for he was a man great of counsel and wisdom, to seek his advice. And they made ready a fleet, and that in secret and in silence, lest that race should know the cause of their errand, or any besides the king and his counselors. And when they were made ready, they went into their ships, Lud and those whom he chose with him, and they began to cleave the seas towards France. And when these tidings came to Lovelace, seeing that he knew not the cause of his brother's ships, he came on the other side to meet him, and with him was a fleet vast of size. And when Lud saw this, he left all the ships out upon the sea except one only, and in that one he came to meet his brother, and he likewise with a single ship came to meet him. And when they were come together, each put his arms about the other's neck, and they welcomed each other with brotherly love. After that Lud had shewn his brother the cause of his errand, Lovelace said that he himself knew the cause of the coming to those lands. And they took counsel together to discourse, 111, on the matter otherwise than thus, in order that the wind might not catch their words, nor the Quranians know what they might say. Then Lovelace caused a long horn to be made of brass, and through this horn they discoursed. But whatsoever words they spoke through this horn, one to the other, neither of them could hear any other but harsh and hostile words. And when Lovelace saw this, and that there was a demon thwarting them and disturbing through this horn, he caused wine to be put therein to wash it. And through the virtue of the wine the demon was driven out of the horn. And when their discourse was unobstructed, Lovelace told his brother that he would give him some insects, whereof he should keep some to breed, lest by chance the like affliction might come a second time. And other of these insects he should take and bruise in water. And he assured him that it would have power to destroy the race of the Quranians. That is to say, that when he came home to his kingdom he should call together all the people both of his own race and of the race of the Quranians for a conference, as though with the intent of making peace between them, and that when they were all together, he should take this charmed water, and cast it over all alike. And he assured him that the water would poison the race of the Quranians, but that it would not slay or harm those of his own race. Picture, p112.jpg. And the second plague, said he, that is in thy dominion, behold it is a dragon. And another dragon of a foreign race is fighting with it, and striving to overcome it. And therefore does your dragon make a fearful outcry. And on this wise mayest thou come to know this. After thou hast returned home, cause the island to be measured in its length and breadth, and in the place where thou dost find the exact central point, there cause a pit to be dug, and cause a cauldron, full of the best mead that can be made, to be put in the pit, with a covering of satin over the face of the cauldron. And then, in thine own person do thou remain there watching, and thou wilt see the dragons fighting in the form of terrific animals. And at length they will take the form of dragons in the air. And last of all, after wearying themselves with fierce and furious fighting, they will fall in the form of two pigs upon the covering, and they will sink in, and the covering with them, and they will draw it down to the very bottom of the cauldron. And they will drink up the whole of the mead, and after that they will sleep.
Thereupon do thou immediately fold the covering around them, and bury them in a kissed vein, in the strongest place thou hast in thy dominions, and hide them in the earth. And as long as they shall bide in that strong place, no plague shall come to the island of Britain from elsewhere. The cause of the third plague, said he, is a mighty man of magic, who takes thy meat and thy drink and thy store. And he through illusions and charms causes everyone to sleep. Therefore it is needful for thee in thy own person to watch thy food and thy provisions. And lest he should overcome thee with sleep, beat there a cauldron of cold water by thy side, and when thou art oppressed with sleep, plunge into the cauldron. Then Lud returned back unto his land, and immediately he summoned to him the whole of his own race and of the Quranians. And as Levelis had taught him, he bruised the insects in water, the which he cast over them all together, and forthwith destroyed the whole tribe of the Quranians, without hurt to any of the Britons. And some time after this Lud caused the island to be measured in its length and in its breadth, and in Oxford he found the central point, and in that place he caused the earth to be dug, and in that pit a cauldron to be set, full of the best mead that could be made, and a covering of satin over the face of it. And he himself watched that night, and while he was there, he beheld the dragons fighting, and when they were weary they fell, and came down upon the top of the satin, and drew it with them to the bottom of the cauldron, and when they had drunk the mead they slept, and in their sleep, Lud folded the covering around them, and in this accursed place he had in Snowdon, he hid them in a kissed vein. Now after that this spot was called Dinas Emraeus, but before that, Dinas Feroan, and thus the fierce outcry ceased in his dominions. And when this was ended, King Lud caused an exceeding great banquet to be prepared, and when it was ready, he placed a vessel of cold water by his side, and he in his own proper person watched it. And as he abode thus clad with arms, about the third watch of the night, lo, he heard many surpassing fascinations and various songs, and drowsiness urged him to sleep. Upon this, lest he should be hindered from his purpose and be overcome by sleep, he went often into the water. And at last, behold, a man of vast size, clad in strong, heavy armor, came in, bearing a hamper, and, as he was wont, he put all the food and provisions of meat and drink into the hamper, and proceeded to go with it forth. And nothing was ever more wonderful to Lud, than that the hamper should hold so much. And thereupon King Lud went after him and spoke unto him thus, "Stop, stop," said he, "though thou hast done many insults and much spoil erewhile, thou shalt not do so any more, unless thy skill in arms and thy prowess be greater than mine." Picture, p115.jpg. Then he instantly put down the hamper on the floor, and awaited him, and a fierce encounter was between them, so that the glittering fire flew out from their arms, and at the last Lud grappled with him, and fate bestowed the victory on Lud, and he threw the plague to the earth. And after he had overcome him by strength and might, he besought his mercy. "How can I grant thee mercy," said the king, "after all the many injuries and wrongs that thou hast done me, all the losses that ever I have caused thee?" Said he, "I will make thee atonement for, equal to what I have taken, and I will never do the like from this time forth, but thy faithful vassal will I be." And the king accepted this from him. And thus Lud freed the island of Britain from the three plagues, and from thenceforth until the end of his life, in prosperous peace did Lud the son of Beli rule the island of Britain. And this tale is called the story of Lud and Levelis. And thus it ends. Picture, p116.jpg. TALISIN. Picture, p117.jpg. In times past there lived in Penland a man of gentle lineage, named Tegid Vol, and his dwelling was in the midst of the lake Tegid, and his wife was called Caridwin. And there was born to him of his wife a son named Morvan Ab Tegid, and also a daughter named Crerwi, the fairest maiden in the world was she, and they had a brother, the most ill-favored man in the world, of Vagdu.
Now Caridwen, his mother, thought that he was not likely to be admitted among men of noble birth, by reason of his ugliness, unless he had some exalted merits or knowledge, for it was in the beginning of Arthur's time and of the Round Table. So she resolved, according to the arts of the books of the Ferelt, 118a, to boil a cauldron of inspiration and science for her son, that his reception might be honorable because of his knowledge of the mysteries of the future state of the world. Then she began to boil the cauldron, which from the beginning of its boiling might not cease to boil for a year and a day, until 3 blessed drops were obtained of the grace of inspiration. And she put Gwyanbach, the son of Grian of Lanfair and Serinion, in powers, to stir the cauldron, and a blind man named Mordid to kindle the fire beneath it, and she charged them that they should not suffer it to cease boiling for the space of a year and a day. And she herself, according to the books of the astronomers, and in planetary hours, gathered every day of all charm-bearing herbs. And one day, towards the end of the year, as Caridwen was culling plants and making incantations, it chanced that 3 drops of the charmed liquor flew out of the cauldron and fell upon the finger of Gwyanbach, and by reason of their great heat he put his finger to his mouth, 118b, and the instant he put those marvel-working drops into his mouth, he foresaw everything that was to come, and perceived that his chief care must be to guard against the wiles of Caridwen. For vast was her skill, and in very great fear he fled towards his own land, and the cauldron burst in two, because all the liquor within it except the 3 charm-bearing drops was poisonous, so that the horses of Gwyanbach here were poisoned by the water of the stream into which the liquor of the cauldron ran, and the confluence of that stream was called the poison of the horses of Gwyanbach from that time forth. Picture, p119.jpg. Thereupon came in Caridwen and saw all the toil of the whole year lost, and she seized a billet of wood and struck the blind Morda on the head until one of his eyes fell out upon his cheek, and he said, "Wrongfully hast thou disfigured me, for I am innocent. Thy loss was not because of me." "Thou speakest truth," said Caridwen, "it was Gwyanbach who robbed me." And she went forth after him, running, and he saw her, and changed himself into a hare and fled. But she changed herself into a greyhound and turned him, and he ran towards a river, and became a fish, and she in the form of an otter bitch chased him under the water, until he was fain to turn himself into a bird of the air. Then she, as a hawk, followed him and gave him no rest in the sky, and just as she was about to stoop upon him, and he was in fear of death, he espied a heap of winnowed wheat on the floor of a barn, and he dropped amongst the wheat, and turned himself into one of the grains. Then she transformed herself into a high-crested black hen, and went to the wheat and scratched it with her feet, and found him out and swallowed him. And, as the story says, she bore him 9 months, and when she was delivered of him, she could not find it in her heart to kill him, by reason of his beauty. So she wrapped him in a leathern bag, and cast him into the sea to the mercy of God, on the 29th day of April. And at that time the weir of Gwydno was on the strand between Divi and Aberystwyth, near to his own castle, and the value of 100 pounds was taken in that weir every May Eve. And in those days Gwydno had an only son named Elphin, the most hapless of youths, and the most needy. And it grieved his father sore, for he thought that he was born in an evil hour. And by the advice of his counsel, his father had granted him the drawing of the weir that year, to see if good luck would ever befall him, and to give him something wherewith to begin the world. Picture, p121.jpg. And the next day, when Elphin went to look, there was nothing in the weir. But as he turned back, he perceived the leathern bag upon a pole of the weir. Then said one of the weir ward unto Elphin, "Thou wast never unlucky until tonight, and now thou hast destroyed the virtues of the weir, which always yielded the value of 100 pounds every May Eve, and tonight there is nothing but this leathern skin within it." "How now," said Elphin, "there may be therein the value of 100 pounds." Well, they took up the leathern bag,
And he who opened it saw the forehead of the boy, and said to Elphin, Behold a radiant brow. 121. Deliezenby he called, said Elphin. And he lifted the boy in his arms, and lamenting his mischance, he placed him sorrowfully behind him. And he made his horse amble gently, that before had been trotting, and he carried him as softly as if he had been sitting in the easiest chair in the world. And presently the boy made a consolation and praise to Elphin, and foretold honor to Elphin, and the consolation was as you may see. Fair Elphin ceased to lament. Let no one be dissatisfied with his own, to despair will bring no advantage. No man sees what supports him, the prayer of Sinlo will not be in vain, God will not violate his promise. Never in quiet knows where was there such good luck as this night. Fair Elphin, dry thy cheeks. Being too sad will not avail, although thou thinkest thou hast no gain, too much grief will bring thee no good, nor doubt the miracles of the Almighty, although I am but little, I am highly gifted. From seas, and from mountains, and from the depths of rivers, God brings wealth to the fortunate man. Elphin of lively qualities, thy resolution is unmanly, thou must not be over sorrowful. Better to trust in God than to forebode ill. Weak and small as I am, on the foaming beach of the ocean, in the day of trouble, I shall be of more service to thee than 300 salmon. Elphin of notable qualities, be not displeased at thy misfortune, although reclined thus weak in my bag, there lies a virtue in my tongue. While I continue thy protector, thou hast not much to fear, remembering the names of the Trinity, none shall be able to harm thee. And this was the first poem that Taliesin ever sang, being to console Elphin in his grief for that the produce of the Wirr was lost, and, what was worse, that all the world would consider that it was through his fault and ill luck. And then Gwenogvryn, 123, asked him what he was, whether man or spirit. Whereupon he sang this tale, and said, First, I have been formed a comely person, in the court of Sir Ridwin I have done penance, though little I was seen, placidly received, I was great on the floor of the place to where I was led. I have been a prize at defense, the sweet muse the cause, and by law without speech I have been liberated by a smiling black old hag, when irritated dreadful her claim when pursued. I have fled with vigor, I have fled as a frog. I have fled in the semblance of a crow, scarcely finding rest. I have fled vehemently. I have fled as a chain. I have fled as a roe into an entangled thicket. I have fled as a wolf cub. I have fled as a wolf in a wilderness. I have fled as a thrush of portending language. I have fled as a fox, used to concurrent bounds of quirks. I have fled as a marten, which did not avail. I have fled as a squirrel, that vainly hides. I have fled as a stag's antler, of rotty course. I have fled as iron in a glowing fire. I have fled as a spearhead, of woe to such as has a wish for it. I have fled as a fierce bull bitterly fighting. I have fled as a bristly boar seen in a ravine. I have fled as a white grain of pure wheat, on the skirt of a hempen sheet entangled, that seemed of the size of a mare's foal, that is filling like a ship on the waters. Into a dark leathern bag I was thrown, and on a boundless sea I was sent adrift, which was to mean an omen of being tenderly nursed, and the Lord God then set me at liberty. Then came Elphin to the house or court of Gwydno his father, and to liaison with him. And Gwydno asked him if he had had a good haul at the weir, and he told him that he had got that which was better than fish. What was that? Said Gwydno. A bard, answered Elphin. Then said Gwydno, Alas! What will he profit thee? And Taliesin himself replied and said, He will profit him more than the were ever profited thee. Asked Gwydno, Art thou able to speak, and thou so little? And Taliesin answered him, I am better able to speak than thou to question me. Let me hear what thou canst say, quoth Gwydno. Then Taliesin sang, In water there is a quality endowed with a blessing. On God it is most just to meditate aright.
To God it is proper to supplicate with seriousness, since no obstacle can there be to obtain a reward from him. Three times have I been born, I know by meditation, it were miserable for a person not to come and obtain all the sciences of the world, collected together in my breast, for I know what has been, what in future will occur. I will supplicate my Lord that I get refuge in him, a regard I may obtain in his grace. The Son of Mary is my trust, great in him is my delight, for in him is the world continually upholden. God has been to instruct me and to raise my expectation, the true Creator of heaven, who affords me protection. It is rightly intended that the saints should daily pray, for God, the Renovator, will bring them to him. Asterisk, asterisk, asterisk. And forthwith Elphin gave his hall to his wife, and she nursed him tenderly and lovingly. Thenceforward Elphin increased in riches more and more day after day, and in love and favor with the king, and their abode Taliesin until he was 13 years old, when Elphin son of Gwydno went by a Christmas invitation to his uncle, Maelgwn Gwynedd, who sometime after this held open court at Christmastide in the castle of Dyganwy, for all the number of his lords of both degrees, both spiritual and temporal, with a vast and thronged host of knights and squires. And amongst them there arose a discourse and discussion. And thus was it said, "Is there in the whole world a king so great as Maelgwn, or one on whom heaven has bestowed so many spiritual gifts as upon him? First, form, and beauty, and meekness, and strength, besides all the powers of the soul?" And together with these they said that heaven had given one gift that exceeded all the others, which was the beauty, and comeliness, and grace, and wisdom, and modesty of his queen, whose virtues surpassed those of all the ladies and noble maidens throughout the whole kingdom. And with this they put questions one to another amongst themselves. Who had braver men? Who had fairer or swifter horses or greyhounds? Who had more skillful or wiser bards than Maelgwn? Now at that time the bards were in great favor with the exalted of the kingdom, and then none performed the office of those who are now called heralds, unless they were learned men, not only expert in the service of kings and princes, but studious and well versed in the lineage, and arms, and exploits of princes and kings, and in discussions concerning foreign kingdoms, and the ancient things of this kingdom, and chiefly in the annals of the first nobles, and also were prepared always with their answers in various languages, Latin, French, Welsh, and English. And together with this they were great chroniclers, and recorders, and skillful in framing verses, and ready in making englands in every one of these languages. Now of these there were at that feast within the palace of Maelgwn as many as 24, and chief of them all was one named Heinvard. When they had all made an end of thus praising the king and his gifts, it befell that Elphin spoke on this wise. Of a truth none but a king may vie with a king, but were he not a king, I would say that my wife was as virtuous as any lady in the kingdom, and also that I have a bard who is more skillful than all the king's bards. In a short space some of his fellows showed the king all the boastings of Elphin, and the king ordered him to be thrown into a strong prison, until he might know the truth as to the virtues of his wife, and the wisdom of his bard. Now when Elphin had been put in a tower of the castle, with a thick chain about his feet, it is said that it was a silver chain, because he was of royal blood. The king, as the story relates, sent his son Run to inquire into the demeanor of Elphin's wife. Now Run was the most graceless man in the world, and there was neither wife nor maiden with whom he had held converse, but was evil spoken of. While Run went in haste towards Elphin's dwelling, being fully minded to bring disgrace upon his wife, Taliesin told his mistress how that the king had placed his master in durance in prison, and how that Run was coming in haste to strive to bring disgrace upon her. Wherefore he caused his mistress to array one of the maids of her kitchen in her apparel, which the noble lady gladly did, and she loaded her hands with the best rings that she and her husband possessed. In this guise Taliesin caused his mistress to put the maiden to sit at the board in her room at supper, and he made her to seem as her mistress,
and the mistress to seem as the maid. And when they were in due time seated at their supper in the manner that has been said, Run suddenly arrived at Elpiachin's dwelling, and was received with joy, for all the servants knew him plainly, and they brought him in haste to the room of their mistress, in the semblance of whom the maid rose up from supper and welcomed him gladly. And afterwards she sat down to supper again the second time, and Run with her. Then Run began jesting with the maid, who still kept the semblance of her mistress. And verily this story shows that the maiden became so intoxicated, that she fell asleep, and the story relates that it was a powder that Run put into the drink, that made her sleep so soundly that she never felt it when he cut from off her hand her little finger, whereon was the signet ring of Elfin, which he had sent to his wife as a token, a short time before. And Run returned to the king with the finger and the ring as a proof, to show that he had cut it from off her hand, without her awaking from her sleep of intemperance. The king rejoiced greatly at these tidings, and he sent for his counselors, to whom he told the whole story from the beginning. And he caused Elfin to be brought out of his prison, and he chided him because of his boast. And he spake unto Elfin on this wise, Elfin, be it known to thee beyond a doubt that it is but folly for a man to trust in the virtues of his wife further than he can see her, and that thou mayest be certain of thy wife's vileness, behold her finger, with thy signet ring upon it, which was cut from her hand last night, while she slept the sleep of intoxication. Then thus spake Elfin, With thy leave, mighty king, I cannot deny my ring, for it is known of many, but verily I assert strongly that the finger around which it is, was never attached to the hand of my wife, for in truth and certainty there are three notable things pertaining to it, none of which ever belonged to any of my wife's fingers. The first of the three is, that it is certain, by your grace's leave, that wheresoever my wife is at this present hour, whether sitting, or standing, or lying down, this ring would never remain upon her thumb, whereas you can plainly see that it was hard to draw it over the joint of the little finger of the hand whence this was cut. The second thing is, that my wife has never let pass one Saturday since I have known her without paring her nails before going to bed, and you can see fully that the nail of this little finger has not been pared for a month. The third is, truly, that the hand whence this finger came was kneading rye dough within 3 days before the finger was cut therefrom, and I can assure your goodness that my wife has never kneaded rye dough since my wife she has been. Then the king was mightily wrath with Elfin for so stoutly withstanding him, respecting the goodness of his wife, wherefore he ordered him to his prison a second time, saying that he should not be loosed thence until he had proved the truth of his boast, as well concerning the wisdom of his bard as the virtues of his wife. In the meantime his wife and Taliesin remained joyful at Elpiachin's dwelling, and Taliesin she wed his mistress how that Elfin was in prison because of them, but he bade her be glad for that he would go to Meulgon's court to free his master. Then she asked him in what manner he would set him free. And he answered her, A journey will I perform, and to the gate I will come, the hall I will enter, and my song I will sing, my speech I will pronounce to silence royal bards. In presence of their chief, I will greet to deride, upon them I will break and Elfin I will free. Should contention arise, in presence of the prince, with summons to the bards for the sweet flowing song, and wizards posing lore and wisdom of druids. In the court of the sons of the distributor, some are who did appear intent on wily schemes, by craft and tricking means, in pangs of affliction to wrong the innocent, let the fools be silent, as erst in Baden's fight. With Arthur of the liberal ones the head, with long red blades, through feasts of testy men, and a chief with his foes. Woe be to them, the fools, when revenge comes on them. Idleason, chief of bards, with a sapient druid's words, will set kind Elfin free from haughty tyrant's bonds. To their fell and chilling cry, by the act of a surprising steed, from the far distant north, there soon shall be an end. Let neither grace nor health be to Mabinogion,
for this force and this wrong, and be extremes of ills and unavenged, and to run and all his race. Short be his course of life, be all his lands laid waste, and long exile be assigned to Melgwined. After this he took leave of his mistress, and came at last to the court of Melgwn, who was going to sit in his hall and dine in his royal state, as it was the custom in those days for kings and princes to do at every chief feast. And as soon as Taliesin entered the hall, he placed himself in a quiet corner, near the place where the bards and the minstrels were wont to come to in doing their service and duty to the king, as is the custom at the high festivals when the bounty is proclaimed. And so, when the bards and the heralds came to cry largesse and to proclaim the power of the king and his strength, at the moment that they passed by the corner wherein he was crouching, Taliesin pouted out his lips after them, and played blurom, blurom, with his finger upon his lips. Neither took they much notice of him as they went by, but proceeded forward till they came before the king, unto whom they made their obeisance with their bodies, as they were wont, without speaking a single word, but pouting out their lips, and making mouths at the king, playing blurom, blurom, upon their lips with their fingers, as they had seen the boy do elsewhere. This sight caused the king to wonder and to deem within himself that they were drunk with many liquors. Wherefore he commanded one of his lords, who served at the board, to go to them and desire them to collect their wits, and to consider where they stood, and what it was fitting for them to do. And this lord did so gladly. But they ceased not from their folly any more than before. Whereupon he sent to them a second time, and a third, desiring them to go forth from the hall. At the last the king ordered one of his squires to give a blow to the chief of them named Heinenvard, and the squire took a broom, and struck him on the head, so that he fell back in his seat. Then he rose and went on his knees, and besought leave of the king's grace to show that this their fault was not through want of knowledge, neither through drunkenness, but by the influence of some spirit that was in the hall. And after this Heinen spoke on this wise: O honorable king, be it known to your grace, that not from the strength of drink, or of too much liquor, are we dumb, without power of speech like drunken men, but through the influence of a spirit that sits in the corner yonder in the form of a child. Forthwith the king commanded the squire to fetch him, and he went to the nook where Taliesin sat, and brought him before the king, who asked him what he was, and whence he came. And he answered the king in verse: Primary chief bard am I to Elfin, and my original country is the region of the summer stars. Idno and Heinen called me Merton, at length every king will call me Taliesin. I was with my lord in the highest sphere, on the fall of Lucifer into the depth of hell. I have borne a banner before Alexander. I know the names of the stars from north to south. I have been on the galaxy at the throne of the distributor. I was in Canaan when Absalom was slain. I conveyed the divine spirit to the level of the Vale of Hebron. I was in the court of Don before the birth of Gwydion. I was instructor to Eli and Enoch. I have been winged by the genius of the splendid Crozier. I have been loquacious prior to being gifted with speech. I was at the place of the crucifixion of the merciful Son of God. I have been 3 periods in the prison of Arianrod. I have been the chief director of the work of the Tower of Nimrod. I am a wonder whose origin is not known. I have been in Asia with Noah in the ark. I have seen the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. I have been in India when Rome was built. I am now come here to the remnant of Troy. I have been with my Lord in the manger of the ass. I strengthened Moses through the water of Jordan. I have been in the firmament with Mary Magdalene. I have obtained the muse from the cauldron of Sir Ridwin. I have been bard of the harp to Leon of Lochlin. I have been on the White Hill, in the court of Cynvelin, for a day and a year in stocks and fetters. I have suffered hunger for the Son of the Virgin. I have been fostered in the land of the deity. I have been teacher to all intelligences. I am able to instruct the whole universe. I shall be until the day of doom on the face of the earth, and it is not known whether my body is flesh or fish. Then I was for 9 months in the womb of the hag Sir Ridwin.
I was originally little Gwyn, and at length I am Taliesin. And when the king and his nobles had heard the song, they wondered much, for they had never heard the like from a boy so young as he. And when the king knew that he was the bard of Elfin, he bade Heinen, his first and wisest bard, to answer Taliesin and to strive with him. But when he came, he could do no other but play Blerom on his lips, and when he sent for the others of the 24 bards, they all did likewise, and could do no other. And Maeldun asked the boy Taliesin what was his errand, and he answered him in song. Puny bards, I am trying to secure the prize, if I can. By a gentle prophetic strain I am endeavoring to retrieve the loss I may have suffered. Complete the attempt, I hope, since Elfin endures trouble in the fortress of Taganwy. On him may there not be laid too many chains and fetters. The chair of the fortress of Taganwy will I again seek. Strengthened by my muse I am powerful. Mighty on my part is what I seek, for 300 songs and more are combined in this spell I sing. There ought not to stand where I am neither stone, neither ring, and there ought not to be about me any bard who may not know that Elfin the son of Gwydno is in the land of Artrol, secured by 13 locks, for praising his instructor. And then I, Taliesin, chief of the bards of the west, shall loosen Elfin out of a golden fetter. *. If you be primary bards to the master of sciences, declare ye mysteries that relate to the inhabitants of the world. There is a noxious creature, from the rampart of Satanas, which has overcome all between the deep and the shallow. Equally wide are his jaws as the mountains of the Alps. Him death will not subdue, nor hand or blades. There is the load of 900 wagons in the hair of his two paws. There is in his head an eye green as the limpid sheet of icicle. Three springs arise in the nape of his neck, sea roughs thereon swim through it. There was the dissolution of the oxen of Deiverdenwy the water gifted. The names of the three springs from the midst of the ocean, one generated brine which is from the Carina, to replenish the flood overseas disappearing. The second, without injury it will fall on us, when there is rain abroad, through the whelming sky. The third will appear through the mountain veins, like a flinty banquet. The work of the King of Kings. You are blundering bards, in too much solicitude. You cannot celebrate the kingdom of the Britons. And I am Taliesin, chief of the bards of the West, who will loosen Elfin out of the golden fetter. *. Be silent, then, ye unlucky rhyming bards, for you cannot judge between truth and falsehood. If you be primary bards formed by heaven, tell your king what his fate will be. It is I who am a diviner and a leading bard, and know every passage in the country of your king. I shall liberate Elfin from the belly of the stony tower, and will tell your king what will befall him. A most strange creature will come from the sea marsh of Rhiannon as a punishment of iniquity on Maeldun Gwynedd. His hair, his teeth, and his eyes being as gold, and this will bring destruction upon Maeldun Gwynedd. *. Discover thou what is the strong creature from before the flood, without flesh, without bone, without vein, without blood, without head, without feet. It will neither be older nor younger than at the beginning. For fear of a denial, there are no rude wants with creatures. Great God! How the sea whitens when first it come. Great are its gusts when it comes from the south. Great are its evaporations when it strikes on coast. It is in the field, it is in the wood, without hand and without foot, without signs of old age, though it be coeval with the five ages or periods. And older still, though they be numberless years. It is also so wide as the surface of the earth, and it was not born, nor was it seen. It will cause consternation wherever God willeth. On sea, and on land, it neither sees, nor is seen. Its course is devious, and will not come when desired. On land and on sea, it is indispensable. It is without an equal, it is four-sided. It is not confined, it is incomparable. It comes from four quarters, it will not be advised, it will not be without advice.
It commences its journey above the marble rock. 136. It is sonorous, it is dumb, it is mild, it is strong, it is bold, when it glances over the land. It is silent, it is vocal, it is clamorous, it is the most noisy on the face of the earth. It is good, it is bad, it is extremely injurious. It is concealed, because sight cannot perceive it. It is noxious, it is beneficial, it is yonder, it is here, it will discompose, but will not repair the injury, it will not suffer for its doings, seeing it is blameless. It is wet, it is dry, it frequently comes, proceeding from the heat of the sun, and the coldness of the moon. The moon is less beneficial, inasmuch as her heat is less. One being has prepared it, out of all creatures, by a tremendous blast, to wreak vengeance on Mabinogion. And while he was thus singing his verse near the door, there arose a mighty storm of wind, so that the king and all his nobles thought that the castle would fall upon their heads. And the king caused them to fetch Elfin in haste from his dungeon, and place them before Taliesin. And it is said that immediately he sang a verse, so that the chains opened from about his feet. I adore the Supreme, Lord of all animation, him that supports the heaven, ruler of every extreme, him that made the water good for all, him who has bestowed each gift, and blesses it. May abundance of mead be given Melgn of Anglesey, who supplies us, from his foaming mead horns, with the choicest pure liquor. Since bees collect, and do not enjoy, we have sparkling distilled mead, which is universally praised. The multitude of creatures which the earth nourishes, God made for man, with a view to enrich him. Some are violent, some are mute, he enjoys them, some are wild, some are tame, the Lord makes them. Part of their produce becomes clothing, for food and beverage till doom will they continue. I entreat the Supreme, Sovereign of the region of peace, to liberate Elfin from banishment, the man who gave me wine, and ale, and mead, with large princely steeds, of beautiful appearance, may he yet give me, and at the end, may God of his good will grant me, in honor, a succession of numberless ages, in the retreat of tranquility. Elfin, knight of mead, late be thy dissolution. And afterwards he sang the ode which is called, The Excellence of the Bards. What was the first man made by the God of Heaven? What the fairest flattering speech that was prepared by Yoyuev? What meat, what drink, what roof his shelter? What the first impression of his primary thinking? What became his clothing? Who carried on a disguise, owing to the wiles of the country, in the beginning? Wherefore should a stone be hard? Why should a thorn be sharp pointed? Who is hard like a flint? Who is salt like brine? Who sweet like honey? Who rides on the gale? Why ridged should be the nose? Why should a wheel be round? Why should the tongue be gifted with speech rather than another member? If thy bards, Heinen, be competent, let them reply to me, Taliesin. And after that he sang the address which is called, The Reproof of the Bards. If thou art a bard completely imbued with genius not to be controlled, be thou not untractable within the court of thy king, until thy rigmarole shall be known, be thou silent, Heinen, as to the name of thy verse, and the name of thy vaunting, and as to the name of thy grandsire prior to his being baptized, and the name of the sphere, and the name of the element, and the name of thy language, and the name of thy region. Avaunt, ye bards above, avaunt, ye bards below. My beloved is below, in the fetter of Arianrod. It is certain you know not how to understand the song I utter, nor clearly how to discriminate between the truth and what is false. Puny bards, crows of the district, why do you not take to flight? A bard that will not silence me, silence may he not obtain, till he goes to be covered under gravel and pebbles. Such as shall listen to me, may God listen to him. Then sang he the piece called, The Spite of the Bards. Minstrels persevere in their false custom, immoral ditties are their delight,
vain and tasteless praise they recite. Falsehood at all times do they utter. The innocent persons they ridicule. Married women they destroy, innocent virgins of Mary they corrupt, as they pass their lives away in vanity. Poor innocent persons they ridicule. At night they get drunk, they sleep the day, in idleness without work they feed themselves. The church they hate, and the tavern they frequent, with thieves and perjured fellows they associate, at courts they inquire after feasts, every senseless word they bring forward, every deadly sin they praise, every vile course of life they lead, through every village, town, and country they stroll, concerning the gripe of death they think not, neither lodging nor charity do they give, indulging in victuals to excess. Psalms or prayers they do not use, tithes or offerings to God they do not pay, on holidays or Sundays they do not worship, vigils or festivals they do not heed. The birds do fly, the fish do swim, the bees collect honey, worms do crawl, everything travails to obtain its food, except minstrels and lazy useless thieves. I deride neither song nor minstrelsy, for they are given by God to lighten thought. But him who abuses them, for blaspheming Jesus and his service. The liaison having set his master free from prison, and having protected the innocence of his wife, and silenced the bards so that not one of them dared to say a word, now brought L.P.H.'s wife before them, and she wed that she had not one finger wanting. Right glad was Elfin, right glad was Taliesin. Then he bade Elfin wager the king, that he had a horse both better and swifter than the king's horses. And this Elfin did, and the day, and the time, and the place were fixed, and the place was that which at this day is called Morvarianid, and thither the king went with all his people, and 24 of the swiftest horses he possessed. And after a long process the course was marked, and the horses were placed for running. Then came Taliesin with 24 twigs of holly, which he had burnt black, and he caused the youth who was to ride his master's horse to place them in his belt, and he gave him orders to let all the king's horses get before him, and as he should overtake one horse after the other, to take one of the twigs and strike the horse with it over the crupper, and then let that twig fall, and after that to take another twig, and do in like manner to every one of the horses, as he should overtake them, and joining the horseman strictly to watch when his own horse should stumble, and to throw down his cap on the spot. All these things did the youth fulfill, giving a blow to every one of the king's horses, and throwing down his cap on the spot where his horse stumbled. And to this spot Taliesin brought his master after his horse had won the race, and he caused Elfin to put workmen to dig a hole there, and when they had dug the ground deep enough, they found a large cauldron full of gold. And then said Taliesin, Elfin, behold a payment and reward unto thee, for having taken me out of the weir, and for having reared me from that time until now. And on this spot stands a pool of water, which is to this time called Plopair. After all this, the king caused Taliesin to be brought before him, and he asked him to recite concerning the creation of man from the beginning, and thereupon he made the poem which is now called, One of the Four Pillars of Song. The Almighty made, down the Hebron vale, with his plastic hands, Adam's fair form, and 500 years, void of any help, there he remained and lay without a soul. He again did form, in comparadise, from a left side rib, bliss throbbing Eve. 7 hours they were the orchard keeping, till Satan brought strife, with wiles from hell. Thence were they driven, cold and shivering, to gain their living, into this world. To bring forth with pain their sons and daughters, to have possession of Asia's land. 25, 10 and 8, she was self-bearing, the mixed burden of man-woman. And once, not hidden, she brought forth Abel, and Cain the forlorn, the homicide. To him and his mate was given a spade, to break up the soil, thus to get bread. The wheat pure and white, summer tilth to sow, every man to feed, till great Yule feast.
an angelic hand from the High Father, brought seed for growing that Eve might sow. But she then did hide of the gift a tenth, and all did not sow of what was dug. Black rye then was found, and not pure wheat grain, to show the mischief thus of thieving. For this thievish act, it is requisite that all men should pay tithe unto God. Of the ruddy wine, planted on sunny days, and on new moon nights, and the white wine. The wheat rich in grain and red flowing wine Christ pure body make, Son of Alpha. The wafer is flesh, the wine is spilt blood, the Trinity's words sanctify them. The concealed books from Emmanuel's hand were brought by Raphael as Adam's gift. When in his old age, to his chin immersed in Jordan's water, keeping a fast, Moses did obtain, in Jordan's water, the aid of the three most special rods. Solomon did obtain, in Babel's tower, all the sciences in Asia land. So did I obtain, in my bardic books, all the sciences of Europe and Africa. Their course, their bearing, their permitted way, and their fate I know, unto the end. Oh, what misery, through extreme of woe, prophecy will show on Troy's race. A coiling serpent, proud and merciless, on her golden wings, from Germany. She will overrun England and Scotland, from Lakeland seashore to the Severn. Then will the bride then be as prisoners, by strangers swayed, from Saxony. Their lord they will praise, their speech they will keep, their land they will lose, except wild Wallia. Till some change shall come, after long penance, when equally rife the two crimes come. Britons then shall have their land and their crown, and the stranger's swarm shall disappear. All the angel's words, as to peace and war, will be fulfilled to Britain's race. He further told the king various prophecies of things that should be in the world, in songs, as follows. *. Picture, p143.jpg. Footnotes. 11a. Diarrhea. 11b. While the day was still young. 13. Aaron, king of Anvin. 15. And as thou sayest. 17. It may be that I shall repent for what I have done unto thee. Seek whom thou wiliest to slay thee, I shall not slay thee. 26. If thou wilt ask for a reasonable gift, thou shalt have it gladly. A reasonable one, Lord, answered he. 28. Will rose, and caused silence to be proclaimed, to command all suitors and minstrels to show what they desired, and to tell them that every one of them would be satisfied according to his wish and desire. 29. And they summoned him to them. 30. Wretched women, said Rhiannon, for the sake of the God who knows everything, charge me not falsely. The God who knows everything knows that that is false. 31a. Whether she persuaded or pleaded. 31b. Unbeseeming. 33. According to the kind of baptism that was then made. 35. O fair lady, said Tarnan, it is not very likely to me that any of these will be carried on thy back. Let who will do so, said the son, I shall not. Truly, my soul, said Tarnan, neither shall we go. 36a. The Welsh is vi and prior I, equals my trouble. 36b. If he will be of gentle bearing. 37a. And if he is in power, it will be more right for him to maintain thee than it was even for me. 37b. After that. 38. Walt. 39a. And splendid wearer of the crown of London. 39b. Overlooking the sea. 40. Penardim. 42. Maine. 45. And I am not sure it was not there he got it. 48a. Taunted him openly. 48b. Bake. 50a. On the township. 50b. There were but two rivers, Lee and Archon were they called.
After that the ocean separated the kingdoms. 52a was. 52b, yes, said Bendigeidvran, unless I myself can get the kingship. 56a, Glyvri. 56b, Gradiu. 59a, at that very moment. 59b, and from that hour they could not rest. 62a, Meek. 62b, wilt thou follow another counsel? 62c, and even now thou wilt not be disappointed with her appearance. 65, Ad, and Fish. 71, he furnished gilded clasps for the shoes. 73, and then, half in guile and half in anger, he rushed into the midst of the mice, but he could no more keep one of them within sight than he could gnats or birds in the air, except one, which he saw was heavy with young, and which he thought could not run. 79, knockers and collars. 81, Eviate. 87, Tibioch. 88, A Maiden. 91, A Aranrot throughout. 91, B Infamous. 93, Seaweed. 96, Destiny. 98, A Ad, according to the rite of baptism they then performed. 98, B, I will give him that one cantrev that is best for a young man to have. 100, Blow. 111, Ad, henceforth. 118, A, of the books of the magician. Virgil equals Feral equals magician or chemist. 118, B, Head. 121, The Liaison. 123, This should be Elfin son of Gwydno. 136, Possibly an allusion to the cave of Eos.